Wampa Wampa?
That's right.
Hey.
Long ago, in a galaxy far, far away,
Star Wars toys
began, and Kenner continues the excitement.
The Empire Strikes Back collection.
El regreso del Jedi.
Welcome to the Star Wars Collectors Archive Podcast. It's the Kivecast.
Present Star Space Station with a snap of its space hat.
Sometimes known as the Vintage Pollen.
Wow, what a weird place!
A monthly audio magazine dedicated to vintage Star Wars toys and memorabilia. Hosted by Skye Payne, Hutt,
Chewbacca,
and Steven B. Dem. Market data mined by Brisbane Brisbane Mike.
Luke Skywalker handles his saber well.
And Fantastic Pete.
Boba Fett has a see-through helmet.
Tech support by The Lobe.
Prince Slade.
FX7.
X-Wing 8.
Lando Calrissian.
Chief Chipper. Biker Scout.
R5-D4. Greedo.
The Emperor.
And Princess Nisei.
And Princess Nisei.
Each sold separately from Kenner's Star Wars Return of the Jedi collection.
Wampa Wampa, space freaks.
Welcome to the late summer edition of the Kivecast.
Yeah, Steve, you know, so it turns out that we actually have an unofficial hiatus time.
Yes, that's true.
It turns out that, like, August is, like, that's when my school starts. It starts at the end of August.
Yeah.
So that's when I always, obviously, do all my editing, is at the very end. So you'd think,
right,
I have the whole month to do it, but it's really hard to record in August.
Yeah.
So what are we going to do, Steve?
But we have, it's kind of a special offer episode, because we're breaking format a bit, but with good reason, I think.
Yeah, we're going to give you two podcasts in September.
Yeah.
Wow, Steve, that's a lot for me to promise. But we're going to have two, we're going to have your regularly scheduled Kivecast about the Rebel Commander Soldier Commando. At some point, I'm going to figure out which one it is, Steve. Is
yep.
It the Cliff Clavin one or the one that Brock collects? I don't know. Again, I talked a lot recently about the show, and people like it when I'm stupid. So that's pretty convenient for me. Yeah, so that'll be our sort of regular episode. We got some good market watches, some good vocabs and stuff. But
yeah,
this month is all about people getting to do cool stuff and talking about it.
Yeah, absolutely. The record kind of scratched with the events that have happened in August, so it's a good way to deal with it, I think.
and basically, for those of you that don't know, so there were two events over the summer. There was Celebration Europe 2, which was
right,
widely publicized, and neither Steve or I went.
No.
And then there was this thing called the International Collectors Event.
Right.
That was an invite-only, like, party in Seattle.
Right.
Now, Steve, we sort of had this problem of talking about how there, you know, is no exclusivity or inner circle-ness to
yeah,
the hobby, and then later in the month going to an exclusive party. But I thought a lot about this, Steve.
Okay, I want to hear your spiel.
It was a party for people who lived in the area and
right,
whoever they could invite that they knew.
Yeah.
So, like as we will discuss, the whole parties happen in people's houses. There's no convention, no anything.
No, no.
So there was like a firm cap limit. So
yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I guess we were lucky to be invited. I guess, you know, because we're
yeah,
loosely affiliated with the podcast or whatever it is.
Yeah.
But that's what that was. So it was exclusionary, but kind of necessarily so. So
yeah.
Someone asked us, what are we going to call the show, Steve? And I had the perfect idea.
Okay.
The Kivecast went to Germany and Seattle, and all you got was this lousy podcast. So, just because those shirts are funny, and
so
I think we'll call it the Lousy Late Summer Podcast. I think that'll
okay,
be the name.
All right, that sounds good.
We'll talk more about that. We'll talk more about the exclusivity. Now, one of the great things that we got to do, Steve, was we got to see Return of the Jedi in its original print. And we'll talk about that later.
Okay.
The upside, or the downside, depending on your opinion, of this half of the podcast.
That's exactly. I was just going to say, that's a two-sided question
yeah,
here.
Was I just sat there with a notebook, and I wrote down over 15 movie observations based
man,
on Return of the Jedi, just watching it.
Yep.
And so we'll start with one of those, and I'll spread them throughout, Steve. Are you ready
okay,
for it?
Oh, yeah. I'm ready.
So I've never noticed this before, but Leia is great for saving Han, mm-hmm. but she commits the lamest act of, like, subterfuge you've ever seen. Watch the scene again where she creeps into Jabba's palace. Okay? So if you can imagine, okay, I'll paint a picture in the mind. So there's your giant arched doorway. She goes down the couple steps.
Oh, there's
probably about 15 feet in between her and the other side of the wall.
It is a very wide entrance to the ballroom there.
She walks 15 feet across the top of the stairwell and hits her head against the wind chimes. And I mean, maybe everyone else has laughed about this before and I'm just late to the party. But, I mean, everyone laughs about the stormtrooper hitting his head. I mean, the door was closing, whatever. That's understandable. You can't see.
Right. Yeah.
And it's not like she was walking that way and she just bumped into it. It was like she was like, okay, must hit my head. And why does Jabba have wind chimes? Like, did someone not know what to get him for Christmas? And, like, I went down to Hemmicker Schlemmicker.
I guess there's got to be a draft from the Rancor pit coming up there. I don't know.
Yeah. Anyway, so that's the first and perhaps lamest. I can promise you and or threaten you with the fact that I've taken many notes on the nature of language and as it's used by Boosh in comparison to how it's used by Jabba. And subject, verb, object.
See, that placement. Sounds like a paper presentation at a conference right there.
Yep. Well, if you keep listening to our show, then you will get to hear more of that. So this is not character centered, and it's not even Skye or Steve centered, except for that last bit.
Right.
What's the word we like to use here at the Kivecast, Steve?
Polyvocal.
Polyvocal. Yeah. You'll get a free Kivecast pin if you can say the first time we use the word polyvocal. I think, Steve, because you and I didn't go to Celebration Europe, all the footage that we have came from Chris Georgoulias.
Right.
And he took it very seriously, and he got a lot of really good footage.
Oh, good.
But we haven't really heard it, and we can't really talk to it. So I think we're going to save that to the end.
Okay.
And I think we should start with what happened second, which was the International Collectors Event.
Sure. That's the fresh thing on our minds.
So, Steve, what was your impression of the International Collectors Event?
Pure exhaustion and exhilaration at the same time. That's how I would sum it up. I was more tired than I think I'd ever been, but more excited than I'd ever been about Star Wars collecting at the same time. So it was a draining yet thrilling experience, to say the least.
Yeah, I mean, it was basically it was like a convention.
Right.
But instead of going to a convention, you just went to the most insane Star Wars collections you've ever seen.
Yep.
And Steve, I can positively say for the rest of my life, I do not have a large Star Wars collection.
No. Yeah, I think we've... a lot of us are in that book.
I mean, the principle of relativity states, you know, that I don't have a large Star Wars collection. So it's good. I can just say, you know, I have kind of a minor thing. So we did record some stuff there. We're going to talk a little bit about it here now. But I think we'll kind of like intersperse it. Does that sound good, Steve?
Yeah.
All right. Well, first of all, the cool thing for me was I wasn't really going to go, you know, because of all the family troubles I touched on.
Right.
I guess, boy, like 3 months ago, whenever we last recorded, Steve.
God, yeah, it's been slackers. Major slackers.
Major. But if we just announced it as a hiatus, Steve, everything would have been okay.
Yeah.
So just get ready for that. You get 11 plus podcasts a year, guaranteed, from the Kivecast Vintage Pod.
Yeah, and I did send out a message on Facebook saying, hey, we have not gone off into the night. We do have stuff coming. You're going to get some surprises. So hopefully that got to some people.
Oh, yeah. That's a good thing to say.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we'll... join our Facebook friends. What do we do? Like us on Facebook?
Yeah, I think that'll do it.
Okay. Like us on Facebook and send us emails, kivecast@gmail.com.
Yep.
So I wasn't really going to go, but I finally got pestered and pestered by the Holy Spirit, Ron Salvatore, and by Matthias, who just said they had an extra room, they didn't feel like, you know, not splitting it, and they kind of knew that I was sort of needed to get out, and so they just kept on pestering me, and I finally just bit the bullet and bought the ticket.
Yeah.
And that was yeah.
Man, I'm just remembering that your arrival and the intricacies of that was interesting.
Oh, yeah, well, you know, because we drove out and we had to, like, get a rental car, and that's, yeah, that's probably not so interesting to and maybe it is, I don't know.
I'm thinking more of the moving of the furniture.
Oh, yeah, because we didn't have a bed, so we stole the couch from Steve's suite. With his lady friend.
She's not my special lady, she's my lady friend. I'm just helping her conceive, man.
Right.
Who you will hear from later in the show.
That's right.
Steve, Cavcast listeners are not going to believe the amount of female human beings they're going to hear on this show.
See, that's a good thing.
I mean, it's literally like fours or fives of them. I mean, it's it's a good thing. You know, we're branching out.
Yeah.
It turns out sitting in your basement in a bathrobe is not the easiest way to get unusual people on your podcast.
No.
Although I am wearing my pink bathrobe now, so
nice.
I'm not kidding. So we showed up, and you know, it's like 2 o'clock in the morning, and I had that, and I missed the room sale, Steve.
What
were those like?
I mean, it was kind of like a mini cantina sale back like from the Celebration 4 in LA. We took over the hotel's bar/restaurant, and the bartender was definitely happy because that was the most business he had had in a long time.
Right.
And it was just, you know, it was your usual fun stuff. I mean, bootlegs, carded figures, you name it. It's some weird things I'd never seen. It was just, it's funny, like, I was more of just soaking that all in. I didn't actually pick up anything at the room sale. It was just like, wow, this is the same exact thing, but just compressed into this Hyatt House.
Right.
Restaurant, which was great in its own way. I think it even involved a fireside chat outside. They had a nice little fire pit out there, and it was just, it's the same thing, but on a micro scale, I guess.
Right. It's cool. I'm kind of glad I missed it in a way, because I went on a 5-day Star Wars adventure, Steve.
Yeah.
And I spent a sum total of $2.47 on Star Wars toys.
Oh, that's good. See, I guess, yeah. Oh.
$2.47. Yeah,
you
I mean, of course,
really
it costs a ton to go there and all that stuff.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was pretty spectacular. So that was sort of like the first night where they had kind of like a mixer where I guess everyone got really drunk.
Well, there was a great, like, one of the Sarlacc crew, who's the Pacific Northwest, I guess, or Seattle area collectors, they kind of gave us the space at this Wine World and Spirits store, which was actually really cool. It was a big open party space where they kind of showed all the initial swag, and everyone was kind of just, you know, saying hello to all these people they hadn't seen in a while, and it was really fun. But yes, it was an open bar, and I think myself included, we all got a little dinged by that, but it was fun.
Yeah, I missed that. I, like, showed up in my suit and everything. I went directly from my class to the plane, and, you know, I took my sort of knockout pills, so I was...
I remember, like, stumbling into the lobby and, like, man, Skye is here!
Yeah. So then the second day was all predicated on this toy run idea.
Right.
So there
were
these two stores, and I guess we should be better reporters, Steve, because we didn't make it to the second store.
No, but we did get some good info about them. Did you talk to anyone that went up there?
Yeah, so apparently there's a store called the Star Wars store?
It's like Somebody and Son's Star Wars store, and it's in Aberdeen, Washington, which, I mean, I guess if you're a Nirvana fan, you may know that's where Kurt Cobain came from, and I knew it just because I happened to pass through one time.
Right.
But that was the furthest away, and after hearing the stories, I am kind of bummed that I missed it.
Yeah. Yeah, it sounds like a pretty amazing place, and you know what we'll do? We'll talk to somebody in the future who's been there and can tell us a story of the Aberdeen toy store.
Okay.
See, we couldn't really go because Matthias and I were driving, and we were with Ron, who was insanely ill. And
yes.
Matthias and I were not as sensitive as I think we probably could have been. We just kind of figured, he'll just be fine.
He'll come out of it.
He'll work it out, and then he'd pull over and puke, and we'd be like, it's probably all gone now. Here, have some water. Dust it off. And it just didn't happen.
No. When I saw Ron, and we were talking about walking up that hill, I'm like, Ron's not going to make that hill, man. We got to get him out of here.
Yeah, I still feel bad. So this is... in case the podcast listeners are ever doubting about my whole, hey, I'm actually a jerk, well, there's proof about that. But Matthias is a jerk, too, so that's good. but before we got to that, we did make it to the first toy store.
Right.
Which, Steve, I don't understand Seattle, okay? That's one thing I'm going to say.
Okay.
I don't understand this store was, like, in the middle of, I mean, like, barns and horses.
Yeah, right, right. It was on an actual, like, ranch property, which, from what we had, it's funny, Tessa and I, we actually got a tour of the facilities outside of the toy store by one of the, I guess it was the husband of the couple who owned the place, and I mean, I guess they just use it as a regular ranch property, and then they just devoted one of the stables to this insanely cool toy store, which you would never expect driving off the side of the road.
Yeah, yeah, no, that was really sweet. You know, I got like a Empire Strikes Back mug with Chewie on it. I got like a Star Wars Galaxy card set postcard from like 1995.
Right on.
Definitely the highlight of that store for me was, you know, because, you know, Steve Sansweet was there, and
yeah,
I got a chance to actually talk to him a few times, which is nice, because if you ever see him at a convention, he's always swamped by fans.
Right.
But, you know, we were kind of walking around, and as people probably don't know, my favorite Star Wars toy of all time is an Episode I toy. it's the Opie fish. It's the big,
wait,
you know,
minute.
Oh, Gooba fish.
Oh, I remember that thing, yeah.
So
the orange-looking one?
Yeah, the orange-looking
yeah,
one.
Yeah,
the toy
okay.
has this mechanism where you press on its back, and its teeth open
the
and
teeth
close.
The teeth chomp? Okay, yeah.
And I don't know why, but it's like, it's a mystically satisfying toy. It's like, it's like, you know the way orange Hostess cupcakes look?
Yeah.
You know how you want them to taste, and they don't taste that way? That's what that toy is. It's that good. And I guess for whatever reason, I guess, you know, Steve Sansweet's covered in toys and he hadn't actually gotten around to play with it. So I was like, oh yeah, check this out. So it's kind of this funny thing of like,
yeah,
let me show the person who knows more about Star Wars toys than anybody in the world something I like about Star Wars toys. So that's pretty fun.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And actually, Steve, we did record a little bit of audio right outside.
We did. That's right.
So why don't we play that for the people?
All right. Sounds good.
Well, Steve, this will be our first recording. We're at the International Collectors something. What's the E stand for, Steve?
Event.
The International Collectors event in Seattle, Washington. We're actually outside. We're near a horse barn at a place called the...
Toy Stable.
The Toy Stable. And it's a really cool Star Wars themed toy store. It's the first place. I had a very eventful trip coming out here. Matthias and I were talking, and we kept on getting lost.
That was the problem when I was trying to guide him from the airport. They were having very serious talks, and we would get diverted quite a bit.
Yeah, we wind up start talking about proof cards, and all of a sudden, we're three exits later.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool, you know, like almost everyone, you know, who's at this event is in this store, all kind of looking for the same resources. A lot of talk about the extremely pin-headed... Brazilian bootlegs. You see these things, Steve?
I didn't see those, no.
Oh, we gotta check out.
Alright, we gotta go back.
Yeah, Yehuda has one. Steve Sansweet bought one.
Okay.
Or as I call him, the other Steve. Yeah, it's pretty cool. I got some Batman stuff for my kid. What did you get, Steve?
I got a pop-up book that I had as a kid. I got a...
The Empire pop-up?
Yep, the Empire one.
Wait, can we play with that once I'm done recording?
Absolutely. I got a surprise for a later show. And then also... The Star Tours pen, yeah.
Yeah, pretty sweet. All I got was like a little mug, a little Chewy mug and a postcard. But I'm really thinking, it's my son's birthday, so I might have what you might call guilt about goofing around in Seattle. But yeah, so we'll kind of check in the next event. But I think it's good to have a sort of in situ, you know, talking about stuff. We actually just went to this urinal. Have you used the urinal over there, the porta potty?
The Colonel Urinal?
Yeah, it's a Max Affordable Portables. The Colonel
of the Urinal.
Of the urinal, which in a Pulley-Up, Washington, which I have to say is my favorite thing I've seen in Washington. It's right up there with Mount Rainier. Did you see that mountain?
Dude, it looks like a matte painting.
It's weird. It's like Mount Fuji or something. It's crazy. Anyways, it turns out there's mountains in Washington. All right, so we're either going to go go some dinner, ride some horses, or potentially buy methamphetamines. I don't know what you do in this area, but I think one of those three things is in order. Hey, Steve?
I think you're on track.
All right, I'm pretty sure all we talked about was the porta potty, but...
I think so.
I talked about the Batman toys I got for Django, because that was actually my son's birthday.
Yeah, that day, that's right.
And it's actually funny because we mentioned Joker Savage last episode, and he texted me or emailed me I owe him an email back. Hey, if I haven't emailed you back yet, I did get your email. And he said, oh, I couldn't go because it was my son's birthday. It's like, oh.
Oh, no.
I did take him bowling, like, the week before with, like, five of his friends, like, by myself. And
yeah.
I'm a good dad, you know. It's just badly timed. So then instead of going to the next lunch and going to the next toy store, we decided to follow you. So you were in the car with Derek and Brock and Steve and Bob.
Yep.
And Tacoma, is that right?
Yeah, Tacoma. Yeah, that's where we headed. There was apparently a crazy arcade, which we sadly missed. We needed some kind of sustenance, and we needed to assess Ron's condition. So we started to head back.
Yeah, so it turns out that Tacoma is a hill, and Steve looked on Google Maps and found this restaurant, and he's like, we should park at the bottom of the hill and walk to the top. I think that was
There is an explanation. Originally, we had parked right near the arcade, the restaurant I looked up, I thought was much closer than it was.
Okay, but it was actually way, way far away.
It was up like a San Francisco-style hill.
Yep. Yeah. And so we walked up, and Bob was nice enough to take Ron back. Once again, Matthias and I could have done the right thing, and we didn't. and we had this, like, really good sandwich and, you know, pretty good beer and it was a nice kind of time. We missed the store, but, I mean, that's what's nice. It was just like any other convention where it's like you have to miss something in order to really appreciate it, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
You can't do everything. And then there was a party that night, Steve.
That's right. And that was the lake, right? Or no?
Yeah, it was on the lake. It was at the Stewarts is the name of the folks.
Yeah, that's right.
And I was kind of, like, uncomfortable sort of at first because it was like, well, I didn't quite, like, it felt more Sarlacc-y, like, because basically there's two groups. There was, like, people who were invited by the organizers and then people who were invited because they were part of the Seattle Club.
Right.
So, obviously, a lot of the Seattle Club are people that I know as well, you know, like, we'll have to talk to them later in the episode. And as we will say later, we were on their podcast.
Yep, that's right.
But then a lot of them are just, you know, collector club people, and obviously they're nice people, but I didn't know them, so I felt a little bit uncomfortable. And also that their house is really cool, but like it wasn't like child safe, so it had like a lot of like steep drops, and I always felt like I was gonna like fall into the lake. That could have been because of the punch. But it was cool, though, because, you know, it was a very beautiful house. It was right on a lake, a really nice collection room. Interestingly enough, they had a Chewbacca bot bag that was just sitting out. Yeah.
Nice. Like ready-to-use bot bag?
Yeah, ready-to-use, like uninflated, but out.
Oh, man, I missed that.
Yeah, it was a really nice collection room. And I actually had a nice chance. So the other person who was there who I never had a chance to talk to was Pete Vilmer.
Yeah.
Who's, you know, beyond co-writing the poster book, which is one of my favorite books. His blog posts on StarWars.com on collecting were always just great. I mean, just top-notch stuff. And I've always liked his writing. So that was really cool to be able to talk to him. And he was really into the bot bag art, too. And so we were kind of sitting there talking about that. And that was nice for a reason that I will get into later, because the Chewbacca bot bag actually makes a return appearance in this podcast. But then they just did these crazy things, Steve.
Yes, it became almost cult-like all of a sudden, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, so they had this bonfire, and they had the idea of having a papier-mâché Vader to burn on the bonfire.
Yeah, and the funniest thing is, when I first got to the house, I walked downstairs, I wanted to check out the lake, and in the pool room downstairs, I saw this giant papier-mâché Vader sitting in the chair. I'm like, that's kind of weird. And a couple hours later, when they said they were going to be doing something, I came back through, and it was gone. And that was when the light bulb went on, and I'm like, oh, that's what's going to happen.
And so this thing is pretty cool, but they didn't tell the people who were standing right next to the dock that on the dock there were fireworks. Yeah. So it was this really cool thing, like, wow, that's cool, there are fireworks. But my initial reaction was, holy, like, I thought I was going to get set on fire. But that was pretty cool, too. I got to be honest with you, that was awesome. Like,
I know it's supposed to be too cool. And the starry sky and all that, it was, I mean, that was, they really had the right spot to do it.
it really did feel like that moment. Yeah. And then it was cool too, because I haven't really had a chance to talk much to Arnie, of Arnie and Marjorie from the Swan podcast. And it was actually really fun because I got to have sort of an argument about the merits of episode 2. Yeah. and the difference between knowledge and wisdom. Unfortunately, I like got a zinger in there, and I feel like I kind of degraded the quality of the debate.
I didn't hear the whole thing. I happened to walk up just as people were starting to make s'mores, and I saw you talking. Like, and then I heard the thing about knowledge and wisdom, and I knew exactly what you were talking about.
Yeah, yeah. But anyways, I was making the pro-Lucas argument, and he was making the anti-Lucas argument.
Yeah, yep.
Which, anyways, but that was really fun. Hopefully, actually, we'd continue that, because I had a lot of fun discussing that. Although, when I high-fived somebody after the singer, I think maybe he thought I was not being
respectful.
Oh, man,
I did see you high-five someone. I didn't realize that was when it was. I saw you high-five somebody. I don't know.
I said something like, you know, I would like to think you're right, but you're not, or something like that, or the only problem is you're wrong. There's something kind of like,
okay.
I didn't mean it to be like that, but it kind of turned out that way.
Gotcha. All right.
Yeah. So that was the first night. The second night.
Second night, yeah.
Then the third day, there was supposed to be a Kessel run, which was just went to all these collectors' places.
Yeah.
And I didn't go, Steve. Did you?
I did. Yeah, it was impossible to see. I think there were about a dozen collections that were just, it's the craziest thing. These, you know, really welcoming people, just having people stop by their house all day to check out their collections. And I think our group made it to about five of them. And just, we were running out of time. There's just no way to see everybody. But it's just crazy to me to think there were that many in such a small geographical area, for one.
Yeah.
But no, it was a total blast. I mean, the highlights, I mean, the first one we saw, it was a gentleman who had a really neat, like, aerospace collection. He was building a plane in his garage, for one. And upstairs, he had all these amazing, like, NASA memorabilia and like, models that designers would actually use to send rockets into space. And it was beautifully displayed. And we also saw the Millennium Falcon collection, which was insane. For you never think there's that many Falcons out there, but there are.
Oh, I wish I'd seen that.
Man, yeah, it was that and more. I'm trying to think what else. We went to Amy's.
So he built a plane in his garage. Steve, I've had the light bulb in my garage out for over a month. Whenever I go in there at night, I have to turn on my iPhone to like walk around and see. Anyways. You know what I'm gonna do after this podcast? I'm gonna go change that light bulb. You can check in on me later. So then you went to Amy. Well, actually, I think Amy's going to be on the podcast later.
Oh, good. Okay, yeah, that's right. I think we did talk to her. Her handmade craft stuff is just insane. I think we went to Kurt Hanks. That was our last stop, was Kurt Hanks. Just another impressive vintage/modern, anything you can think of collection. It's just, you ran out of time. There was no way to see everything. It was really cool of them to just open their stuff up for people they'd never met before.
Awesome.
It was great.
Well, I didn't do that because...
You had a reason. Yeah.
I had a reason. So, Matthias, I'm going to be putting that drop in a lot. By the way, I mean, the whole time we were there, almost any time anyone would say Matthias, someone would go, ha, ha, ha. And at one point, Matthias had a little way too much lot to drink. And he was just sitting in the back of the car just going, ha, ha, ha. Because he couldn't quite articulate it. It's pretty funny. Once again, Steve, that is our lasting contribution to humanity.
Yes. If anything, that's it.
If anything, that's it. Vic and Lisa are these two very famous collectors who also live in Seattle.
Right.
And they're famous for having a beautiful collection, which we'll talk about, an amazing collection, but also having a lot of stuff that they don't showcase.
Yeah.
So it's been well known that they have a gigantic drawer filled with nothing but proofs and chromolins.
Just insanity.
I mean, filled. And so Matthias asked if he could come photograph all of those proofs. We're talking hundreds, hundreds, hundreds of proofs.
Yeah.
And so I was like, I'll come. How can I help? Can I carry a camera? Can I balance your f-stop? I mean, what can I possibly do? So he invited me out to do that. So it took us about 4 hours, and we'll talk about the rest of the collection later. And we just sat there, and I organized them by movie. I mean, Steve, it was just like...
It was like nerd heaven.
Because I was like, okay, here's all the 3PO proofs. Here's all the Vader proofs. Here's all the Chewbacca proofs. Okay, let's move on to ESP. Okay, here's all the Best Begar proofs.
Oh,
okay,
man.
Go
ahead.
So that was worth the trip. I mean, seeing you and being, you know, together with all my great friends and everything, that's fine. But getting to see this and getting to, like, confirm some things that we didn't know if they existed.
Right, right.
And just, it was just so awesome. I mean, it wasn't quite like an archaeological dig because, you know, I was just opening up a drawer. But it did kind of have that feel. But what was even more fun about that was that we were there with Ron. And at some point, Steve, we're going to have a mega episode, I think, about 2D versus 3D.
Ooh.
So people who you know, collect more the figural prototypes versus those who collect the paper prototypes.
Yeah.
Because to Ron, all of the proof stuff is just kind of boring and who cares in dime a dozen. So it was kind of funny to have him there laughing and smiling at us while we were sitting there just like, oh my Raven, it's a 79 back. But I mean, literally, Steve, I've been working on a thesis based on this, based on predilections, and it's going to be good when we finally talk about it.
Yeah.
Anyway, so that's what I did, and we'll get back to Vic and Lisa's. But that night, we actually got to go to the Bobacabana.
That's right, the home of the emperor of the podcast.
That's right. So we got to go to Gus's house, and this was like, it's really cool because I remember, you know, I think I started collecting vintage very seriously about a decade ago.
Yeah.
And obviously my first stop was the archive, and I remember clicking on the pictures of the Bobacabana and just thinking, like, that would be so cool if someday I would ever get to go there, just even for 5 minutes.
Yeah, yep.
And I didn't just get to go there. Like, we got to, like, party there, you know?
Yeah, it was a party at the Bobacabana, yeah.
And, it literally is impossible to say how impressive of a collection it is.
Yeah.
It's weird because he's moved into props, and so I knew that he had a lot of props. I didn't know that he had, oh my God, that's a lot of props.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
He's famous for having the Death Star, but he's had that for over a decade, right?
Right. It's still insane to see when you open the door.
Yeah, it is pretty special. But then the other things, I guess some of the things he wants to keep secret, others he doesn't. The one that he did say is okay to talk about, I mean, he has Luke Skywalker's belt.
Yeah,
I mean, out of here. Oh, it's like, I don't even really care about props. But that made me care about props, because I was like, okay, that's cool.
It's still, when the fact that it makes you care, I mean, it shows how much it means. It's just it's insane.
But anyways, this is not the prop cast.
Right.
Although, to tell you the truth, I actually would listen to that. I got to say, because listening to Gus talk to me about, like, screen matching and all that stuff, that was pretty fun.
Oh, God, it's a whole other world.
Yeah, it's a very dangerous world that fourth-year professor cannot afford to step into.
Yeah, that is true.
But, man, so... I mean, I suppose most of you have seen things from the collection. What's so cool about it is, you know, there's the prototype room.
Right.
Which is amazing.
Yep.
And there's the prop room. And there's, to be honest, Steve, the cereal room is one of my favorites.
Oh, you instantly want breakfast when you walk in there.
You instantly want breakfast. And, like, Gus has always been teased for how much he loves the cereal stuff. But it's clear. I mean, there is no more, you know, definitive Star Wars serial collection that could even be imagined, you know?
Yeah.
It's really cool. And then just everywhere you go, there's the cast and crew room. There's the vintage carded room, which for most people would
be... Oh, that's right.
That would be their whole collection, you know?
Yeah, that's one thought I had, because they had put an expansion in their house to house and display more stuff. And one of the craziest things to me is that he's taking a tour through, and I happen to be in the room when he came in. It's like... This one room represents the entire U.S. Kenner run of everything. And it's all in one room all together. And it's just one room of many. So it was just crazy to think about it in that kind of way.
Yeah. And I mean, I'm sure I'm forgetting stuff, and we'll probably talk about it as time goes on.
Yeah.
The cool thing was we got to see a ton of nuggets. I mean,
oh my God!
I think we saw almost every nugget on the whole dang archive in the span.
I think
10 hours. I saw every nugget.
Yeah.
And most of the unloved items.
Right, right. That's the greatest thing about it. Is we really did get to see everything in person.
Now, what we have, I actually recorded like maybe 15 different segments there.
Yeah.
We're going to make a lot of references to where we're recording, but only yes. because it was so funny. So let this be the first one.
Okay.
So there's over 150 Star Wars fans, I think, crawling over Gus's house like a bunch of greedy ants, okay?
Yep.
And they're all sitting there, and they're staring at, you know, the complete collection of unproduced 12-inch toys and, you know, the sculpt for Chewbacca, the original figure. And then Gus's wife has the Stitch collection from Lilo and Stitch.
With a capital T,
you know, whatever Gus has in Star Wars, she has the equivalent for Stitch. So, first of all, there was one room that we weren't even really allowed to see that was just filled with Stitches. And then there was two other rooms filled with gorilla racks, piled floor to ceiling with Stitches.
Yep.
And so I first went in there to record thinking, oh, well, no one wants, I mean, no offense, Pam, but no one's going to, like, spend a lot of time staring at plush Stitches when, you know, there's a complete set of unproduced droids and Ewoks prototypes in the next room. But then it had the added effect of being completely padded.
Yes.
So I think, Steve, it's the best place we've ever recorded.
Oh, no, it was the most quiet, dead still. It felt like one of those little recording booths.
Yeah, so I'm thinking in the future, if we really hit it big, we should actually like get ourselves two different studios and just fill them top to bottom with Stitch toys.
Yep.
So anyway, so why don't we start with you and I having a little chat?
Okay.
All right, so I'm running out of battery here, Steve, but I found the one place you can record in the Bobacabana.
It's a different kind of recording studio. You have the insulation, but it's actually Lilo and Stitch insulation.
Yeah, we're in the Lilo and Stitch room. Not too many Star Wars collectors here. So, Steve, what's been your highlight of the Bobacabana?
Well, the artwork for the B-Wing pilot coin is sitting upstairs, and that was something I was not expecting to see. So I think I'm still kind of recovering.
Yeah, I'd have to say it was the Jaipur snippet from episode one.
Oh my God! Seeing the fact that I'm saying "Oh my God," it's just it's revealing that I really know what he's talking about.
Yeah, yeah. No, I you know what it is actually. We'll show this. It's this cool thing where it was for Wonder Bread.
Yeah,
and it was like an interior promotion for Wonder Bread, saying like this: the galaxy's best profits are with Wonder Bread and Star Wars. And, like, as far as vintage memorabilia, just saying right there, it's all about profit.
Yep. Who doesn't need it?
All right. Well, awesome. I think we're running out of batteries. We're going to talk more, a lot more, hopefully the next couple of days. But there's way, way too many Stitches around here.
See, I'm thinking, like, what if these all came to life and killed us all?
It'd be a good death. All right. So that was us. So I guess that was weird, hearing us in the past.
A little bit.
And actually, though, Steve, you and I were not the first people to record there.
No, that's
even
true.
Even though this is an unlikely episode, a very strange episode, there is a haiku. But it was not a skyku. Apparently, Ann Jenkins, wife of super collector Duncan Jenkins, who I think we have to expand the Trinity because we need to fit him somewhere in there.
He does belong.
The patron saint of unloved items, I mean.
Maybe, yeah.
No, I mean, is that quite dignified enough, but I think he might appreciate it. I don't know. He listens to the show. He could say what he thinks about being the patron saint of unloved items. We do like, if anyone wants to do like a stained glass image of like Duncan, like holding, what's like the most unloved thing?
Oh, man, I think we got to go with the speedboat or
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, that'd be great. That'd be great. Okay. I think that's a pretty hard thing. Anyway, so she came up with a haiku for Lando. So how about we have a listen to that?
Yeah, let's hear it.
Okay, so would you please say who you are for the podcast listeners?
I'm Ann Jenkins.
And we're here in the middle of the Bobacabana. We're actually with all the stitches. We don't know which one is a valuable one or not, but they're all pretty cool. And she came up and told me that she wrote her own Lando haiku. And she's just told it to me, and it is exquisite. So here's Ann Jenkins, Lando haiku.
Lando, friend or foe, ever changing as a cape, blowing in the wind.
There you go. You see, she was afraid if it doesn't have the background sound, it won't be good. But I'll put on the little Japanese katana thing going on, or whatever you call that flute, and that'll have it. Thank you so much, Anne.
You're welcome.
All right, now for the next couple interviews, basically what we did is we just continued to ask that question, what's your favorite thing here? Was it a good question?
I mean, it's the easiest question to ask. It's the toughest one to answer, I think. So It's a good question because there's got to be something, right? It's just it takes a lot of thought to really pin it down, I think.
Yeah. So I think we're going to listen to, I don't even think I have a full list here. Of all of them, but I'm going to introduce them all as you hear them. So we'll kind of go for a bunch here, and then we'll take a little break.
Before we actually hear something different.
All right, so we're here with Isaac Liu. Now, I think this is your first time talking on the podcast, Isaac?
I believe it is. I recorded something at Celebration Europe with Chris, but I'm not sure if that ever made it onto the podcast.
That's going to be in this month's episode.
Okay, so I'll be on it twice, I guess?
Yeah, you'll be on twice. Nice. It's very exciting.
Not bad.
So what's your favorite item from the Bobacabana?
Wow. It's hard to say. There's so many incredible things. I think some of the props are just... amazing. I don't know. I've always liked Grand Moff Tarkin's pants for some reason.
Because it's fun saying Tarkin pants.
It's nice to say, oh, look, I have that guy's pants from the movie, you know?
Yeah.
And it's very recognizable. So that's one of my top favorite things, but everything here is pretty amazing.
Yeah, awesome. Well, we're trying to get as many voices as we can here in the Stitch recording studios. Awesome. Well, we'll hear from you later as well.
Absolutely.
All right. Now, Jared, we're here with Jared, and it's pretty exciting because he earlier today was trying to imply that I look down on Ewok stuff. And, Jared, I put the dang Princess Kanisa on the new intro just for you. Now, do you understand that I love Ewoks and I accept them?
It's pronounced Nisa, but, no, I do understand. I was just giving you a hard time, Skye, that's all.
So what in the whole Bobacabana, what have you seen that's just been your absolute takeaway item, the thing you just can't believe and just love more than anything?
The Power of the Force 2 Stormtrooper. No, just kidding. probably the A-Wing fighter artwork.
Oh, yeah, that's beautiful.
It's like 3 feet by 3 feet. It's huge. It's absolutely huge. I don't even understand why it's so big.
Yeah, when I walked in, I thought it was like 5 times larger than it was supposed to be.
Yeah, it's a great piece. And another question we have is you're wearing your Wampa 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 shirt, which you say came before the Kivecast, which I believe. What is the story of the Wampa 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 shirt?
Okay. Well, the Kivecast technically did exist because I made this for Celebration 5, so that statement was incorrect.
Okay.
So you got me. I'm sorry. But I just remember the part in the ad when the Wampa's running away and going, Wampa Wampa Wampa, Wampa Wampa Wampa. So I did the triple Wampa. So it was kind of the Wampa running in fear.
Right.
Yeah, so...
All right, we'll have to get a picture of that for the show, but thanks for coming by, and I guess we'll have to... What should we do for him to Photoshop? Have you ever made him Photoshop himself? Can we Photoshop Jared as Stitch?
We'll talk about that one. All right, thanks, guys.
Yeah, thanks for coming on, Jared.
Okay, so Bob Steffi, Power Droid Collector, I guess extraordinaire, also the nicest guy. So anyways, he had a funny reaction to what would you say when, what's your thoughts of the Bobacabana? What did you say, Bob?
It makes me sad because it is just so incredible. I feel like I've just done it all wrong. I should just sell everything and get out and just walk away. That's my reaction. It's amazing.
Now, do you have one favorite item from the Bobacabana?
There's so many. I mean, obviously the power droid 4-up stuff is really cool. But there's, I mean, it's just, you just walk around the corner and there's just something just sitting in the, you know, every corner you walk around, there's something just amazing that you didn't even know, maybe you didn't know existed, and it's just sitting there like it's nothing.
Yep.
And it's something that probably costs more than, you know, everything that I own.
Well, do you want to know what's my favorite thing in the Bobacabana, Bob?
Yes, I do.
You. Thank you so much, Bob. We'll see you next time.
See you, Bob.
Now, this next one gets kind of special because there's a whole bunch of people talking. It starts with Jeff Carell. I think it goes to, like, maybe Brian. No, it goes to Brad Portnoy, it goes to Bill Cable. I think that's when Amy shows up. And then Pete Gilmore shows up, and then Duncan's there. And so it wound up to where we then moved into this room, which is like the sort of assorted room.
Yeah.
Where there's like these different food premiums, and there was this beautiful Oral-B Jedi Masters display, and just, you know, a full, like, like display and assorted stuff. And when I talked previously about my favorite thing being the Wonder Bread Galaxy of Prophets, that was in this room.
Yep.
And so what's cool was to be in this room, and I was with the exact right people, because Pete Gilmore collects a lot of really cool, kind of obscure stuff, and has a really wide knowledge. And Duncan, obviously, the patron saint of unloved items, to just hang around next to them and say, "Oh, look at that!" You know what I mean? Like, because I don't really know. You know, like I can watch baseball, but if you watch baseball with a professional pitcher, he'll be able to be like, "Oh man, he's tipping this, going to be a 12-6 curveball, whatever it is." You know what I mean? Like the level of detail, this is the right person to be with. So it kind of morphs into a conversation about Harper's Dog Chow premiums and skinless Frankfurters. Which, again, there are so many highlights of the weekend, but definitely learning about skinless Frankfurter premiums from Pete and Duncan was, that was a real lesson in how to love the unloved. So while we may not have the unloved drop, please consider this to be that section.
All right, so we're here with Jeff Carell, who suggests that we take all of the stitches, throw them on the floor, and jump in a pile. Do you really think we should do that, Jeff?
We probably shouldn't do that, but it would be fun if we did, so it's tempting.
I think that we could, with all the stitches, we could fill an entire room just entirely with stitches and just not be able to breathe.
It'd be like a big ball pit. I mean, they have round heads, so.
Speaking
of which, there's one on your head.
A little dusty. So this is your first time on the show, is that correct, Jeff?
This is my first time, yes.
And this is despite the fact that we were roommates and despite the fact that you won the C-3PO's eating competition.
Absolutely. And designed books and medallions and Star Tots and all that kind of stuff.
Okay, so that was, to be honest, it was all Steve. He has a personal problem with you, Steve, isn't that true?
Yep, I can't stand Jeff.
No. Yeah, this is actually awkward. We're kind of in between here. But so did you have any lasting effects from winning the C-3PO competition?
You know, I decided that was my dinner that night, so it was actually really close. I think Brad was right behind me on that, but...
Yeah, he was. But
it's something, a title I'm proud to say that I can hold, so...
Yeah, well, we're coming up with new stuff for the Celebration 7 party. But, so we got us the sort of the question of the day. What do you think, what's your favorite item in the Bobacabana?
I knew that was going to be the question, and that's a hard question to answer.
It is.
Probably going to be up there in that prototype room, and I will say I'm going to say the Amanaman sculpt.
Oh, yeah. So that's, I guess we'll be able to like sort of show pictures as we do this. It's going to be really hard to edit. But anyways, yeah, so there's the original sculpt. What is it exactly?
Yeah, the original sculpture for the Man-A-Man figure, Kenner figure.
Yeah, that's a pretty sweet one. Oh, Steve's like just vigorously saying no. Dude, what? Stop swearing. Okay, all right. All right, now, well, you guys can hug and make up. So, Jeff, we'll have to have you on again sometime in a real interview fashion, some kind of round table thing.
Sure, yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah, and you don't have to almost kill yourself to do it.
I don't know.
Okay. are you guys good?
I think we're all right, right?
We can shake hands. Okay. We can be friends.
And they're shaking hands.
That right, was cool. A wimpy shake, but yeah.
What can I say?
Oh, and it starts again. All right, thanks, Jeff.
Thanks, Jeff.
No, we're here with the Huda Kleinman, and he's actually another very nice guy in the hobby.
lies, all lies.
No, it's not lies because, you know, I packed and I got ready to go to this whole thing, a 5-day packing, and I had my little suitcase and I was all set. And then I looked down and I realized that I didn't pack any socks. So I'm wearing Yehuda's very fancy dress socks.
Tell the truth, Scott. You have my underwear, too.
I do. That's strictly for comfort. But, yeah, so we really want to thank him for that. But we're asking him the question of the Bobacabana because it's the easiest question I could think of. What is your favorite item in the Bobacabana?
Sky, it is you. You are my favorite item in the Bobacabana. My favorite item here. Oh, my God. So, first of all, coming here is like dying and going to heaven. I don't know. It's a freaking hard question.
It is a hard question. You just answer it though.
The beer. let me think. All right. So, in the room where the prototypes are, there's a concept model for an R2-D2 which actually beeps, like the Power of the Force figures that did that later. And what's nice about that is this was the first idea of going to the next step in action figure collecting. And this is a figure that would have beeped and would have started to talk. And the concept came out in 1985, which was way ahead of anything else, and it was never produced. So I stole it, and it's in my pocket. And but just don't tell Gus.
All right. Well, good answer for not having an answer. All right, cool. And hey, yeah. We're also here with Brad, who had a very exciting moment today with a Chewbacca prop. What was that, Brad?
I believe it was one of the Super Live Adventure masks from Japan that was used in Disneyland in Japan. I was able to put that on and wear it and pretend that I was Chewbacca, even though I'm about 5'6", not 7'9".
Yeah, it was very cool. I was a little bit intimidated to ask the prop guy to wear it, and you know you have to be brave and daring, and so Brad was able to do that. I felt a little bit too shy, but as one Chewbacca collector to another, I think I might know the answer to this question, but you never know. But what's your favorite? We're talking with Brad Portnoy, and did I ever say that, Steve?
You can say it again.
Yeah, you can talk too. You don't have to be silent.
I'm just the microphone holder guy.
So Steve's like holding the microphone up to our faces, but you know he can talk too. You know. You know, like 6 out of 10, you know, listeners prefer you to me. The other three are lying.
See, it just makes it better for me. I'm just a premium.
Yeah, that's right. So what's your favorite item in the Bobacabana?
There are plenty of Chewbacca items that would be considered my favorite. But surprisingly, I'd have to say, when you first walk in the door, you see the actual Death Star. The full-sized prop that is just unbelievable. It's a key piece. I think it's iconic. It's just beautiful. And I think that has to be my favorite piece in the collection.
All right. I was actually going to go with the banana cereal, which is just wicked. It's apparently from South Africa, and it's got the Chewbacca Endor image. And I believe, Brad, you can help me out with this. Is there any other licensed Chewbacca memorabilia that is permitted to have any allusions to anything like simian, like monkeys or gorillas or apes? I can't think of anything. So having a banana cereal with Chewbacca seems to me to be rare. What do you think as a fellow Chewbacca collector?
I think it's a perfect match. Unfortunately, people think of him as a giant man ape, but it's okay. He holds his own.
He's a monkey bear dog. He's not an ape.
He's a monkey who likes bananas, and that's where the whole confusion stands in.
Anyways, all right. Thank you so much, Brad. Thank you, Yehuda. We'll get some more people in this amazingly hot and filled with Stitch room.
My pleasure.
It's the right place to record. All right, so we're back in the Stitch Studio A with Bill Cable, C-3PO collector and enthusiast. Bill, what would be your top Bobacabana item?
For my focus collection, it would be the Droids 3PO Paintmaster with the swatches.
So what is a Paintmaster and what is swatches?
Paintmaster is a figure that the workers at Kenner painted certain colors to be used to tell all the factories you have to make the figures these colors. So they have the swatches, so they have, it's like the proof sheet of the color palette for the figures themselves.
And they and Gus has that 4C3PO in this building right here.
Yes, he does. Yes, he does.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Steve, you're the one who's going to talk to Bill, right? Because Steve hasn't
talking. I'm not the best interviewer. I got to admit, I'll interject anything here and there, but it's more only it's Sky territory.
All right. Well, cool. Well, it's been It's been cool talking to Bill then. See, that's what you can say. You can
see, this will be the interview that tanked all because of my misdirection. Nothing to do with Bill.
Questions to yeah. expand upon my...
But I will say, as far as bootleg fan-made shirts, Bill, that's one of my favorites. It's C-3PO playing the role of a young Jodie Foster in the Coppertone commercial, having his bathing suit taken down by R2-D2, and that is quite nice.
Yeah, it was a gift by Mark Salati, so... This is his humor, not mine. It's the most horrible T-shirt I've ever owned.
Meanwhile, the stitches are collapsing.
Yeah,
we've got to get Bill out of here
before we all die. There's an albino stitch?
There is an albino stitch. There are a lot of stitches. All right, thanks
Bill.
Yep.
Okay, so we're now here. This is Steve. I think we're having a record number of non-male people talking on the podcast. This is like two.
It's a start.
It's a start. So we're here with Amy. Is it pronounced Sjoborg or Sjoborg? Or?
Just Sjoborg.
Sjoborg. And let's see. We got this, like, what do you call it?
It's like a handcrafted Star Wars pin. I started doing them about a year ago at Celebration.
So it's a handcrafted pin. We'll take a picture of it. Hopefully you'll be able to see how I tried to cover up my Izod crocodile with it.
And I thought that's what you were trying to go for with that.
Yeah, well, you know, I wear a lot of Izod being a French professor, but this is just, if it was up to me, this would be on all my shirts. So it's just, there's a lot of great fan-made stuff all over here. And this is just some of the cutest and such clearly hard work. But this has actually all been stalling, so Amy can answer the question. What is the one item in the Bobacabana that she thinks is just the coolest thing?
I'm still thinking. I kind of visually going through each room in my head, yeah, and I still see the food room has the R2-D2 soda dispenser from Japan, which is not that rare, but I do want that. And then the other room, there's this Brazil Ewoks VHS tote, and I want that. And then in the cast and crew room, there's several items that I would love to have, mainly like patches and glassware and stuff from the ranch. Right. But I would exchange that for the trip to the ranch. So I'd be cool with that. And then in the house, well, you know, the Death Star is pretty cool.
Well, cool. Well, we'll have to try and pick. I think the best answer is probably the 45 tote or the
VHS tote.
The VHS tote.
Yeah, I think that's the most unique. Therefore, it wins.
Yep. So there's your answer, Amy. Thank you.
Thanks, Amy.
Thank you for coming in and talking to us, and thanks for the pin.
Sorry to interrupt your drop.
So this is very exciting. We have Pete Vilmer here, Star Wars author, collector, and all-around smart, nice guy. Right, Pete? Is that how you describe yourself?
That is exactly how I describe myself. Thank you.
And we're here in the Stitch Studios, and I've had a lot of fun, actually, walking around, because, you know, you go to Gus's rooms and stuff, and the best thing to do is to go into a room with someone who knows way more than you do and see what they find interesting. Because that's like, so we were in this room with all these, like, food premiums and stuff, and I was there with Pete, and I just kind of looked at Mick, that's cool, and then I wait for him to point something like, oh, that's got to be something really cool. So anyways, so what, Pete, would you say is the sort of the one item you would say is your sort of grail from the Bobacabana?
Okay. Well, my favorite item is a prop. And it was a prop that I had no idea had survived the original shoot. It's the A New Hope Luke utility belt from the Tatooine.
Yeah.
Incredible that it has survived. The reason I like it, I have a personal connection to it because when I was 8, Star Wars had come out. Halloween, I was going to be Luke Skywalker. I was in karate at the time, so I had the gi. I just needed the utility belt. So I had to, you know, examine, scrutinize any images I could of Luke's utility belt to create for my Halloween costume. So, in studying the very fine details of the pouches and the various parts of the belt, that's just why I've got a personal connection to it.
That's an awesome answer. I was hoping that your answer was going to be those skinless hot dogs. Could you describe what those are, too? Because that was the thing where we were in the room, and you were like, this is great. There's some kind of skinless hot dog premium. Can you describe that in a way that won't get me arrested in 3 states?
Sure. Okay, so in Britain, there was, they're kind of sausage hot dogs, and there were some Letrosets rub-down transfer premiums associated with them. It had never been, nobody had ever found the actual promotional material for this campaign. And it came up in auction a couple, maybe 2-3 years ago. Gus actually outbid me on the piece. It's extremely unusual and is probably my second favorite piece.
Okay. So, you know, if you had to just take one item, be the utility belt and then the hot dog piece. We'll have to take a picture so that we can have that on the enhanced version. So, anyways, we'll have to have you on again, talk about posters and stuff like that. But thanks for coming on, Pete.
Yeah, thanks, Pete.
Anytime.
All right, cool. All right, so this is kind of a special moment. We've moved out of the Stitch studio, and we're now in sort of the food premium area where we've been talking about the skinless sausages with Pete. And Duncan Jenkins, of course, longtime co-author with Gus on a whole bunch of great books, which you can all buy through completistpublishing.com.
Stupidity.
Publications. Completistpublications.com. Very good.
Okay, because I've called you the completionarist a couple times today. It's been pretty bad. So, you know, we're looking at Harper's Dog Chow. Is this a full set of Harper's Dog Chow premiums?
I believe he's missing one of them. There's a set of 12, and it's just actually impossible. There's Steve, obviously, Steve Sansweet has a full set. But that was actually due to the generosity of Gus, because when Gus bought this set, he knew that Steve just was missing the one, and actually the two of them worked together so that Steve could get the finishing one for his set, and then he could get these. So I believe he's only missing one.
And what is a Harper's Dog Chow?
Was from Australia, and dog chow, I think, is self-explanatory, so it is here in the food room, even though it's not for human consumption usually. But I guess if you're a big Star Wars collector and wanted to get all the stickers, you might help Fido eat a few if he wasn't eating fast enough. But they were in these really big bags of dog chow for Return of the Jedi. And like I said, there was a set of 12, so you really had to have some obese dogs in order to get a full set.
Now, I just came up with this theory right now, right? So Dog Chow, that's owned by Ralston Purina, yes?
Correct.
So then Harper's must also be owned by Ralston Purina.
Or, not always. There was a similar deal with Burger King in Australia, where they had the same name, but it was a different company. And so they changed their name, I believe. I can't remember what they changed their name to, but... The big fast food place in Australia right now is actually owned by Burger King, but they have a different name.
Huh, because I was thinking, you know how Leia Hoth has the little Purina logo?
So, right.
I was wondering if there's some kind of link there, because also if you watch Alien, you see the Purina logo also. Like, what was going on in the 70s where we all thought that the future would be filled with Purina logos?
Right, and General Riken, or he also, yeah. Uh-huh.
He did, yeah. I mean, that's not a question to ask Duncan Jenkins in the middle of Gus Lopez's food premium room, but it has to be said. I mean, it has to be said. Oh, wow. Awesome. Is there anything else in here that you think our audience needs to know? Because this is a room filled with things our audience needs to know about.
Oh, yeah. There's a lot of just fantastic pieces in here. I don't even know where to begin there. I just love all the food premiums, so I could go on and on about any of those. But I don't know if we have enough time for that. So maybe another episode?
All right, another episode. That sounds good. All right, hopefully we'll catch you later in the Stitch Room to ask you the stock question of the night. But thanks, Duncan. And Pete, too, for... Yeah, bringing up the sausages.
So the sticker he's missing is...
Wait, now one second. Now, the second I hit stop, all of a sudden everyone starts saying the ones that he's missing. Okay, so Gus has Salacious Crumb, Han Solo, Princess Leia trying to get C-3PO to shut up, which is a great shot, Wicket, Luke, pointing Vader, looks like some kind of Endor scene, Vader and Luke fighting... Jabba the Hutt and a Gamorrean guard, but he's missing two? So what two is he missing? Who knows in the audience here?
I only know one. One is B-Wing. I think it's kind of inspired by Macquarie. I'm not sure of
The exploding Star Destroyer. But I don't remember what the other one is, but I do believe if you buy our book and look inside, it will tell you.
Yes, that's right. Completist Publishing.
Publications.
God.
Stupidity.
Steve. Completistpublications.com.
Right.
There we go.
And it's after cost, yeah.
Oh, it's funny. It's not
this
quite
a TV dinner.
Yes.
Yeah. It's extraordinary.
Safari supper. Yeah.
Safari
supper. Okay. All right, so I think we'll just finish out with a couple more commentary. I think we got Ron in there, where he at some point poses with an inappropriate stitch.
turns out there is like a Leather Daddy Stitch and like a Bong Happy Stitch, which it's funny because I think Pam thought I was asking her to humor her, but I really was asking her. And in between going to the two of the most impressive Star Wars collections I've ever seen within 24 hours, I was really happy to see something that wasn't Star Wars in Leather Daddy, because it was needed to cleanse the palate, like I said.
Yeah.
Which is actually funny because in between the Bobacabana and Vic and Lisa's when I first went, I made a stop. I said, I need to cleanse my palate. And we took Matthias to Arby's.
Oh, man. See, there was something, you had mentioned something about Arby's. I totally forgot about that.
Yeah, he'd never been to Arby's, so we taught him how to order the sandwich and eat it. And we don't really do commercials on the show, but Arby's gets a bad rap, man. That's actually a bad sandwich.
I'm totally on board with you, man.
I mean, I think it was the Simpsons joke, I'm so hungry I would eat at Arby's. I think that's what he said.
I'm so hungry I could eat at Arby's. Oh my god!
Really hungry. I always go by the Simpsons joke, but it's really not that bad.
No, there's nothing wrong with Arby's. No.
that's our commercial. Right. It was actually funny because I was thinking of also naming the show So It's Come to This, a podcast clip show. The first clip show the Simpsons released was called So It's Come to This.
I remember that.
But this is a different kind of clip show because it's all new stuff.
Yeah.
So yeah, let's have a listen to the rest of our fellow collectors wax on about the amazing Bobacabana. All
right. So we've actually been photographed and filmed by Brian Stillman, who's still hard at work making Plastic Galaxy, and he's going to tell us his favorite item. He's actually looking on his cell phone right now to try and find the answer. He's very technologically minded.
There are so many things here. I need my own notes to remember what I actually liked. Just what I've seen, just to process it. I have to outsource my brain to my phone in order to remember it all and to get through it. So
external hard drive.
It is. Absolutely. I feel like saying the Death Star it should be it's like a bell curve. You have to cut off the Death Star to even bring anything else into the running. So besides the Death Star, because it's the Death Star. Let's one more time. The Death Star. Yeah. The single most significant symbol of the entire franchise. So besides that, I really Luke's belt, Pete said, is awesome because it's Luke. And when I was a kid, I was Luke's the best. And I remember taking one of my dad's belts and putting that in hanging random pouches, my mom's smaller purses and whatever random that I could find, stuff I could find, I would hang off it. But I also really like the original art for the back of the 12-back card, where it's the particularly the lightsaber drawing, because I really love the whole Kenner lightsaber thing. As weird, sort of dorky as it is, just this little thing that comes out of someone's arm, I think it's awesome. And it's the painting of the double telescoping lightsaber, so everything about it's really cool. And it gets to, sort of another, it's an attempt by Kenner to capture another important symbol of Star Wars, the lightsaber. That's the thing every kid walks away remembering. And this was their attempt to do something, anything with it. So that, and then that painting is the ground zero of it. You know what I mean? It's the pure, so I really love that.
That's good. Yeah. We'll probably cut out the first two because someone else has said that, but we love your lightsaber idea. Yep. Right?
No, it's the Genesis,
I think we have to tell people from now on, no Death Star, no belts.
No, because we've hit two or three on each of those so far, so it's understandable.
Including me, so it's a bad sign.
The problem is you can't name just one. I mean, I said that, and in my head I'm already going, and also this, and also this, and also this. But I know you're asking a lot of people, so I don't want to say, and also those, because then other people will be like, that was already said already. So,
my
damn
favorite
it.
Thing is the Halloween Stitch. Nobody mentions the Halloween Stitch.
Oh, well, we're going to get Pam in here to talk about her favorite Stitch.
I think that's important.
All right, so we're here with Tom. Any fancy pronunciation of your last name?
Burgess.
Not like Burgess or...
No, it's the Americanized Burgess.
And so, also, you're a podcaster as well.
And so you want to promote your podcast and our podcast?
Well, let me go with IGrewUpStarWars.com, right?
Okay.
Episode 4, I was on your podcast. That's still cool. Remember it?
That was, yeah, it's crazy how long ago that was.
That was before you, Steve, so...
Well,
was
no, no, it was it was before Steve was on interviews at all.
Yeah.
So I interviewed you by myself,
right?
And then Steve talked about it later. But still, he still doesn't like to do interviews. You see, he's not doing anything.
Why not? Oh, and so anyway,
I turned into Chris Farley on that SNL sketch. That's why.
Yeah, all right. Nice. And I'm also on Galaxy of Toys podcast.
Yeah, and that's, let's see, so who's the, it's you and three others, right?
Right, Ryan Beasy, Jason Luttrell, and Chris B.
Yeah, so cool. So if you want to listen to another podcast, they do a lot of vintage stuff, Steve.
Not so much. We don't want to step on anybody's toes, so it's mostly modern stuff. So.
Oh, go ahead and step on our toes.
There's no such thing. Yeah.
I think. But I mean, you know, I heard you're going to be coming out with a 12-inch Kenner thing featuring Gus soon.
Yeah. It's
is that
it's
supposed to be
it's,
secret.
No. It's it's dropping in about a couple days. So I think we're going Monday or Tuesday. So that's going to be kind of fun.
Cool. It's going to take me weeks to edit this. So anyway, so go and check it out, and because it's a. It's cool, yeah. I listened to the first couple ones. I've been a little bit behind. But
cool. Was there a question that we wanted to ask about the...
There is, but, you know, we're just talking.
Oh, okay.
We're just talking. So
I got time.
No, so what is your... I mean, you're local here, so you've probably been here a lot. What is your favorite item in the Bobacabana?
My favorite item, the prototype 12-inchers are really cool.
Yeah.
But I would have to say walking into the new room, just seeing all of the carded... All the carded figures is just amazing. So I would probably have to go with the carded figures.
I was thinking about it. You walk in there, it does take a whole room to have the whole vintage US set in one. It's a room.
It's a complete collection in a room, which is fantastic. Yeah, it's incredible. So
yeah. When I walked in there, I thought it's kind of unfair. It's like you got props, you got pre-production, you got unproduced, and then you got the whole, you know, the whole just the whole room of just, the whole production American set. So, yeah, that's pretty sweet.
Then what you know now, I remember, actually, I'm pretty sure that Gus got a lot of them in a particular antique shop in early 90s, maybe late 80s. There was an antique shop, actually, in Pioneer Square. I don't know if you guys got down there.
No.
Oh, so anyway, there were boxes and boxes and boxes of these figures at an antique shop, and they were in abundance back then, it seems like. So it was an amazing, weird time, and I'm sure that's where a lot of these carded figures kind of ended up in the Seattle area.
Yeah, he was saying that he got them locally, and I didn't get the full story, but that's... There you go.
Yeah, I would think that maybe a few of those were probably ones that I was flipping through when I was kind of a post-teen years. So, yeah.
After growing up Star Wars, but before talking about growing up Star Wars, that was where you were flipping through them.
There was that in-between time. Absolutely, Skye. That's for sure.
Oh, that's awesome. A little bit of story time added in there.
Tiklo Comedy.
All right, cool. So why don't you give out the name of your site again and the podcast?
IGrewUpStarWars.com, and if you guys have time, check out Galaxy of Toys podcast.
All right, thanks, Tom.
Thanks, guys.
All right,
thanks.
All right, so I'm here with Stephen Brahe Danley, and his lady friend.
Lady friend.
Not my lady friend, right?
What?
I'm
not your lady friend.
Explain.
I don't know what he's talking about. I am so sorry, Tessa. I don't. This is terrible. No, it's a Big Lebowski line.
Oh.
Because he refers to Maude. The guy says, "You're your lady friend." She's not my lady friend, man.
She's not my special lady. She's my lady friend. I'm just helping her conceive, man.
Spilling a beverage.
I see. Yeah, I remember that. I remember.
So anyways, this is a pretty exciting moment. Is this your first official Star Wars event you've attended?
It is. It is my very first.
Is it your last?
It's not my last. I don't think it's my last.
Well, it's very, very brave of you, because not everyone shows up. But, you know, I don't know what you know of all this, and you're not allowed to say Steve. But what is your favorite thing that you've seen in the Bobacabana?
My favorite thing is there are some yearbooks in the basement, hidden away. But it's very young George Lucas, young Carrie Fisher. There's a Harrison Ford who's he looks very young, obviously. Those are my favorite.
Yeah, awesome. Well, obviously, you're into dating high school age guys, so it's
my thing.
Yeah, rocking the cradle of Steve, you know. I see. She actually listens to the show, and she told me that she likes it when I make fun of Steve. So we can expect more of that. So
that's true.
All right, Steve, have I embarrassed her enough?
No.
Have I embarrassed?
No.
No.
We're good.
All right, cool. All right. Thank you, Tessa, the lady friend.
Thank you.
Relax, man. I'm a brother Seamus.
Brother Seamus? Like an Irish monk?
What are you talking about? My name is Delfino. I'm a private snoop like you, man. What? A dick, man? Now, let me tell you something. I dig your work. Playing one side against the other in bed with everybody is fabulous stuff, man.
I'm not... It, man. Just stay away from my fucking lady friend.
Hey, I'm not messing with your special lady.
She's not my special lady. She's my lady friend. I'm just helping her conceive, man.
Hey, man, I'm not...
Who are you working for? Lebowski? Jackie Treehorn?
The Knutsons.
Who the fuck are the Knutsons?
The Knutsons. It's a wandering daughter job. Bonnie Lebowski, man. Her real name is Fawn Knutson. Her parents want her back, see?
And stay away from my special, from my lady friend, man.
So I think this is the third or fourth time we've had Derek Uncle Gundy Ho on the show. How are you doing today, Derek? Doing good?
I'm doing good. Doing good. Very happy to be here.
So, well, you sound like a politician. Very happy to be here. So what is your favorite item in the Bobacabana?
Oh, man. I there's so many Star Wars stuff here, but I think the thing that I covered most here, I was just speaking to Bob, is actually the Spaceballs action figures.
Oh, those are so sweet.
Oh, man. I didn't know he had them. Some of the other stuff, I mean, he's publicized before. I've seen it somewhere online or during the panels at Celebration, but it was an amazing, it was a pleasant surprise to see that four figures displayed in his place.
Yeah, those are so great because that's like the first time they ever made fun of Star Wars toys and the merchandising. And oh man, that's a great answer, Derek.
And it would be a perfect crossover of everything I like, movie props, action figures, toys, and Star Wars related.
It's okay, I can edit that out. All right, Derek, I better stop you before you keep swearing.
Okay.
And plus, I don't know where Steve went.
Okay, bye-bye.
We are here with the Holy Ghost, Ron Salvatore. How you doing, Ron?
I'm surrounded by stitches.
Yeah, surrounded by stitches. Actually, God is right outside the door right here, giving his tour of his heavenly kingdom. I'm really running with this, Steve. What do you think of that?
Let's just go with it. It's all right.
Yeah. It's just, I don't know how Stitch would fit into this whole pantheon. But yeah, we've been having a good time. What we've been doing, Ron, is we've been inviting people in here, and then they've been saying what's their favorite item in the Bobacabana. So what would you say, Ron, is your favorite item in the Bobacabana? His mouth is open. He's thinking.
His eyes are widening.
He's making out with the Stitch. Ron, get away.
My favorite item in the Bobacabana. This is... You needed to give me some preparation for this because I don't know what to say.
That's what everyone says, so it's all right.
I can't say Stitch. I really like Stitch, you know?
Yeah,
I'm looking for this particular Stitch for a while.
The Japanese schoolgirl Stitch?
The Japanese schoolgirl Stitch is pretty fly.
It is, actually.
Aside from that...
I think we'd take a picture of you with it. I don't know.
We'll have to ask Penny. I don't know if this is really my favorite item, but the one that springs to mind off the top of my head is the Leia Bespin doll, which isn't one of a kind or anything, but I just always really liked that doll. And admired it once again in Gus's collection up there. And
Oh, Pam, can we take a picture of Ron with a Japanese schoolgirl Stitch?
And aside from the Japanese schoolgirl Stitch, the Leia Bespin unproduced doll is probably my favorite, but this is my other favorite.
Yeah. I mean, he's got his feminine side, you know, his masculine side. And CJ, we can have you in here as well, you know. This is our recording studio. This is Stitch Recording Studio A.
Are you recording?
recording?
Yes. Yeah, because see, the sound gets deadened by all the plush. You walk in here.
You're recording for the podcast. Yeah. Oh.
Stupidest thing ever.
What are you talking about?
What is your favorite item in the Bobacabana besides schoolgirl Stitch?
Because I already picked that.
Oh.
Is there another one that's sort of just as effeminate?
Well,
because I'll pick that one.
Well, Pam's been telling us about there's like a ganja man Stitch. There's another one that she was describing as being a particular. We got her looking in the archives now. So what is your?
I mean, all the Stitches are awesome.
It should be noted that this is not the only Stitch room. This is only one of two.
Yeah,
Studio A. We got Studio B down the hall.
That's where we recorded "Be My Baby" or "Be My Stitch."
I just can't believe there are this many different Stitches.
Wow, Stitch here. And Angel is stitching his girlfriend.
Oh my goodness! So this is Pot Leaf Stitch. So there's an actual.
Are these all licensed?
It's
amazing how many Stitches there are.
Oh wow!
Lilo and Stitch tag that's got the hologram on it with mouse ears.
There you go.
Dude, this is licensed.
It's been okay. It's been accepted in Seattle and stitched them.
Yeah, wow!
This is my favorite Stitch now.
That was the question, CJ. The question was, what was your favorite?
He looks stoned. He's like.
Yeah, let's get a picture of that. Here we go. Hold up the stone Stitch. With Pam in the back. All right.
How did I get roped into this again? I don't know how this happened.
How can you not?
Okay. I got to go because I was looking for my people. We got to go because we got to go whale watching tomorrow.
All right. Have fun.
Safe travels, CJ.
Good luck with the rest of the podcast.
Don't get strapped to the whale by a harpoon.
I'll do my best.
Don't go Ahab out there.
All right. Well, thanks, Ron and Pam and CJ. Phew, Steven, I said this would just take us half an hour to record. It's going on to 45 minutes, and we're not even halfway through.
Ah, no, we're doing all right.
Are you doing okay? Right. Do you have a hot date tonight?
Grocery store.
Grocery store, okay. You go to Ralph's or Vaughn's?
It depends. Usually Vaughn's, I guess. It's the closest.
See, when I lived in L.A., I could only go to Ralph's because of Big Lebowski. Like, I had to...
Oh, yeah. No, that I totally understand that.
That had such a strong pull on me. I absolutely had to go to Ralph's. Is there a Ralph's around here? Speaking of advertising.
Corporate sponsorship. This is great.
Yeah, no kidding, hey? So then the next day, we got to go to a town... what was the name of that town again?
North Bend, Washington.
Oh, right.
Not to be confused with North Bend, Oregon. North Bend, Washington.
Right. So, your lady friend. So she's from North Bend, Oregon.
Oregon. Yep, that's right.
She's from North Bend, Oregon.
Gone. Who knows?
Which is it? I actually don't know.
I go by Oregon. So does she. So okay. I'm trusting that.
Well, then I will go by Oregonians. but yes, this was North Bend, Seattle. Which was where they had the Return of the Jedi filming.
Right.
But I didn't know it was also where they filmed Twin Peaks.
Yeah.
So, to tell you the truth, like, I was so overwhelmed that whole... Like, just the fact I got to order cherry pie and coffee at Agent Cooper's diner was just unbelievable. You know, it was like a total surprise.
Total surreal morning, I have to say.
Because if I had to choose, you know, honestly, if I had to choose between, you know, going to a concert I really liked and going to the Twin Peaks Diner, it would be a toss-up. Like, I love visiting locations of places that mean something to me. Like, that's my favorite way to travel. It's my favorite way to do anything. Because it takes you to places that you wouldn't normally go. You know, like, when you travel normally, like, everything gets centralized. Like, oh, we have to go to the science museum. We have to go to the art museum. So, like, you spend your time, like, in Chicago... traveling to a gigantic building where art from France and Egypt is shoved in, and you sit there with a bunch of other tourists. But like, if you were looking for the location of, you know, Jake Elwood's apartment in Blues Brothers, man, you'd see some, like, real Chicago. You know what I mean?
You're
traveling, and you'd have that link. So that's my favorite way of tourism, is movie location tourism.
Yeah, it's the way to go.
Which is also, by the way, a very good way to see L.A., because
it's true.
L.A. is a terrible place to visit. It's a great place to live.
Oh, yeah. No,
but there's nothing to do. Like, oh, look at the ground. oh, look at the hill, you know?
And then you have to drive, you know, 45 minutes to get 2 miles away. So.
Yeah. But yeah. If you want to go see Nancy's house from Nightmare on Elm Street, that's easy. It's right there, you know? Anyways. You know, Steve, I said it wasn't going to be all about us, but look at me spouting off.
It's all right. We got enough content to balance, I think.
We do. So anyway, so that was a special treat, although I will say the coffee was actually not damn fine. And I think the pie came from the store. But, you know, they don't have to make it good because they have a reputation.
No, it's the vibe you get, necessarily the product itself.
And another highlight was they got to make the marquee.
Yes.
So it said on the side, speaking of movies I love, puppet show and Max Rebo Band. And I am a fanatical Spinal Tap fan as well.
Oh man, we just watched that like a week ago. it was perfect.
Yeah, it's that's one of my goals. I have one of the three signatures on my DVD of Spinal Tap. Yeah. I have him sign it with a black marker on the black part. So all I got to do is track down everyone who's not Derek Smalls. But yeah, so that was really cool, and that was kind of a fun nod. And it turns out it was Gus's idea, so I was able to say, like, whose idea was that? And he was happy I pointed that out.
Yeah.
So they had free popcorn.
Yep.
And soda, which, again, I love free popcorn and soda. That was very worth it.
Yes.
See, this is weird, isn't it, going through all this?
It's good in a way, because I feel like I'm coming to terms with it almost.
Yeah. I also feel bad, because we had so much fun, and if you didn't go...
Yeah, well...
Should we put, like, a disclaimer, like, if you don't like feeling like you didn't have fun, don't listen?
It's all good. It is what it is.
Okay, so that's as close as I'm going to get to saying that I go too far in this episode, so... But yeah, and so there they were, and they were going to show Return of the Jedi.
Right.
Someone actually, I found a shower curtain on the ground while I was taking a walk, and so I was starting to do the Star Wars kid a lot.
Oh, okay. See, I was wondering where that came from. I ran into that in a different occurrence in the hotel hallway, which...
Yeah, there may be a video released of me doing the Star Wars kid. I was hoping to get everybody to do it, but no one else wanted to do it, so it just left me. But I suggest try doing it, because it's really fun to try to imitate someone imitating something. But anyway, so someone was trying to get me to go up on the stage and do it, but I wouldn't. But instead, what did we see, Steve?
Well, we saw a rough cut of Brian Stillman's Plastic Galaxy, which was awesome. I mean, it got me so excited to just for the movie in general, and then it felt the exact right time to see it, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, it was the right
audience in the room to see it.
Yeah, total surprise, right? I wasn't expecting that.
No.
Yeah, and he just, and, you know, it was great, and obviously I felt bad for him because he clearly, you know, when you're so close to a project, it's so nerve-wracking showing it before you feel it's done. Even if you do feel it's done, it's nerve-wracking.
Sure. No, absolutely.
But he handled it really well, and it went really well, and it was great, and I think it's going to be a really great movie. So, I mean, I don't want to talk about it too much because it was sort of a sneak peek.
Right.
Peek sneak. But I can say that what we saw was great, and we're going to see more, and I think it's going to be great.
Yeah.
And then we got to watch Return of the Jedi.
Yeah, no, and it's funny, like, I had seen Return of the Jedi on the big screen only once before the special editions, which I count myself as lucky for that. Back in Santa Barbara, they would show the original trilogy maybe once a year at the Arlington Theater.
Oh,
and,
really?
When I was, yeah, no, it, maybe it was every couple of years. But
life isn't good enough. No. We also got to watch the original trilogy.
But that was when I was like, must have been like 1993. It was the last time I saw that movie in its original form on the big screen. So I felt like I was going back to that. It was incredible.
Wow, yeah. I am a big Lucas defender. But when you watch the original cut of Return of the Jedi, it is an enormously better movie. Like, it is a significantly better movie than the movie that you can watch now.
Yeah.
Like, it's not like a dips and dabs here and there. And even like watching the laser discs, which I've done, like it doesn't quite have that same feeling, you know.
Right.
I've never been like, come on, man, give me back my childhood. But come on, man, give me back my childhood.
Cause that,
it was also seeing it in the theater and you know, the warmth of the film. But that was, I was surprised how much I enjoyed watching that movie again. I just leaned over at the end. It was just like, this is a great movie. it really is a great movie.
What was funny to me is like, every other screening of a Star Wars movie I've been to, there's been like a really rowdy audience. And the fact that it was so quiet in there, almost, it was weird to process. It's like, I know people are really into this, but it's not like, it's not the same thing as you would see in a, it's just different. It was strange to me how quiet it was in there.
Yeah, I was so afraid that people were going to be like doing lots of like laughing and like saying along the lines and lighting up the lightsabers and trying to have it be like, you know, like it was at Celebration, you know. I watched all six movies or whatever. I watched a couple of them at Celebration four.
Yeah.
When you went to the Dodgers game.
Oh, that's what you were doing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, I was doing. I chose poorly. it was just so cool to not have anyone like snarkily. I mean, there's a little bit of snarky laughs when Yub Nub came up instead of the other one. That was just great, and just to get free popcorn bags, and just, we haven't even talked about all the giveaways, which are just ridiculous.
God.
Steve, how much time do we have to actually talk about these giveaways?
I have a feeling that it may have been well covered in other podcasts.
Yeah.
I'm just going to say, I hope they did, because...
yeah, because we're not going to talk about the giveaways. We're just going to talk about the experience.
Yeah.
But if you really want to know, just send us an email, kivecast@gmail.com.
Yeah.
So that was just really cool. It wasn't cooler than watching Revenge of the Sith in the same movie theater as Mark Hamill, Ahmed Best, and Dave Winfield. Dave Winfield was there.
What?
I don't know why, but that's...
Winfield puts it over the top. But then you said Dave Winfield. I'm like, all right, okay.
Yeah, I mean, watching Luke be born in the presence of Luke, that was definitely cool, because my wife was pregnant with our first son at the same time.
So it's starting to get transcendental, man.
But having John Ratzenberger and Dave Winfield in there as well was pretty sweet. Oh, yeah. Speaking of which, the Red Sox have won the series... the season series against the Yankees. So,
oh my God!
If you have an advice for what to name Brock's team next year, please let us know. Kivecast@gmail.com. I'm not going to be too mean, but I'm just trying to think.
Oh man!
So that was a chance to see the movie, and then just right up the street, we got to go to Vic and Lisa's. I think they call it the Death Star Theater Collection.
Right. Oh my goodness. I mean, that's like the throw in the towel kind of experience.
Yeah. I don't think I've ever been in a nicer house.
Yeah. I mean, I would define it as a Star Wars compound, if anything else. I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, we actually have to go quickly through all the amazing things.
Yes. Yeah.
It's like we have to go through the theater, which has like the doors that go zzzz, you know?
Yep, yep.
Which, if you understand what I mean, suck it, because I think it's clear. and like, you know, 5 points around sound, whatever it is, and just totally comfortable seats, and just...
And then, like, designed by Doug Chang, right? I think, from what I understood, he was...
No.
Yeah.
That's why those drawings were up there?
I believe so.
Oh, man,
yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So there was that, and then... Well, actually, we do have to spend a little more time in the pinball room, Steve.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay, so... They have every Star Wars pinball machine ever made.
I mean, that was more pinball machines related to Star Wars than I'd ever seen, so...
Yeah, I mean, to the point where people didn't actually know what some of them were.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, I'm talking about, like, you know, people who know about Star Wars toys, not people who don't know if we're talking about the Rebel Commando or Rebel Commander or next episode. no, wait, Rebel Soldier. Which one is it, Steve?
Soldier.
Soldier, okay. Rebel Warrock Soldier. yeah, and so they had these pinball machines, but they had them all on free play.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm a huge pinball fan, so that would have been enough for me just to go there and be able to play the Data East Star Wars pinball.
That was my favorite pinball machine of all time, even though I was terrible when I played you head-to-head. But.
Yeah, well, I mean, everybody who came up against me was decimated, but that's okay, Steve.
Okay, all right, so I feel a little bit better.
That was one of my passions at one point, was pinball. I am, of course, a man of many passions. So that was just an amazing chance, and they had all these, they had, like, the rare Australian Empire Strikes Back one that people had never seen. They had, and I will show pictures from, should we do like a whole special on pinball machines at some point?
Man, I think we have enough content to do it now.
Yeah, I think, you mean like we should do it some other time, right?
Well, I mean, yeah, we can preface it here.
We'll tease it. We're going to have a whole pinball discussion based on what we saw there.
Yeah.
And then of course, Tesla's Day was made. Why was that, Steve?
Oh, they had one of the original TARDIS machines from Doctor Who just sitting in the arcade. Yeah. And it's funny, I mean, that was one thing, but then when you open it up, it's full of Doctor Who toys, which it just, yeah. No, that pretty much sealed the trip for her, I think.
Yeah, that was a definite bonus. And I've told a few of my students, because students are big fans of, a lot of female students are huge Doctor Who fans. Mm-hmm. And so, like, actually one of them was wearing a Dalek shirt today. I'm like, you know what I saw? I saw a real Dalek. So, yeah, and that's without going into their collection room, so let's see. Of all of the items, let's see, they had the art for Boba Fett from the holiday special that we featured.
Yep.
Yeah,
many nuggets from the archive.
Yeah,
also
yeah, many nuggets. Yeah, yeah, I mean, a lot of blueprints, a ton of original art. A lot of future nuggets. I think that's what it will really be, Steve.
It's that's true, yeah.
Because they had things there. So they had some early stage art for the bop bag. And that was what blew my mind, was I had talked to Pete the night before about, hey, I wonder if any original artwork or any pre-production items exist for the bop bags.
Yeah.
And boom, right there. There it was.
There it is. Yeah. No.
So, and I don't really fully understand the depth of their 3D collection, just because I don't understand the terminology that well. But you had a lot of people standing over display cases just for hours.
I think I went at least 3 rounds through it just to begin processing it. And I still haven't, really.
Yeah. And they had their whole own prop room. They had their own storyboards, and there's actually a discovery in the storyboard.
Oh, that's right. That's
which
right.
Which was recorded right here.
Good.
Okay, so we have an amazing discovery here. Introduce yourself to what your discovery is.
My name's Bobby Sharp, and I did not discover it, but Yehuda did.
Okay,
we're looking at this Death Tower sketch.
You mean Death Star Tower sketch. That's exactly hard to say. Say 5 times at home, kids.
I don't know why you heard something different, because that's exactly what I said. But if you look at this Death Star Tower sketch, at the base of the Death Star Tower sketch, say that 10 times quicker.
There's a horse.
There's a horse with a guy and a bicycle. And there are a family.
A dog.
And a couple of guys playing baseball over there.
And it's called?
And it's called Sith City.
Bobby. Oh my goodness. You are absolutely right. There is a horse. It appears to be Clint Eastwood as the man with no name. There is a man on a bicycle. It does say Sith City. There's someone lying down on the ground. There's someone peeing. There's someone peeing on it.
It's the who.
Look, there's someone peeing on the wall.
Oh. No wonder they lost the war.
There's a family with a dog and a child.
Unbelievable.
And guys playing baseball.
What's the score?
Sort of a menorah.
Yeah.
And they're all dead because,
wow, that is quite the find.
I peed on so many things, I can't imagine I missed it. Yeah.
Well, that's pretty exciting. Thank you very much, Yehuda, Mr. Sansweet, and Mr. Bobby.
What are we looking at? Can someone point this out to me, please?
Okay.
So there's the story of the Who's Next storyboard. And I mean, to be honest, Steve, I don't know how much more we can talk about. It was just amazing. I think Hivecast listeners will say, oh great, they're talking about how they saw that at Vic and Lisa's again, because they'll just hear it kind of over and over again.
Yeah.
Especially when we talk about the importance of 2D stuff versus 3D stuff, because they have a lot of attention. Another cool thing is they had all the modern stuff.
There was a whole second floor that was all, you know, modern prototypes, modern toys. Yeah, I mean, you name it.
Just any of the Gentle Giant things that you've ever seen, any of the sideshow things you've ever seen, where you go, A, who buys this stuff? And B, I wonder if that's cool. Like, they had all of it.
Yeah.
So as much as I wanted to spend hours upon hours staring at the uncut proof sheet of 12 backs, I also wanted to sit there staring at the cool like sculpture of like Ewoks whipping the hell out of a stormtrooper like in 3D and like had the I mean just every one of those cool sculptures they had. Which they are pieces of art. They're maybe not as interesting as collectibles, but they are very interesting as pieces of art.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was the sort of last party. It got definitely some folks probably drank a little too much there at the end. There's some guy there who was serving hot dogs.
Yes, I was just going to mention the hot dog vendor.
Yeah, hot dog vendor, which turns out cream cheese on a hot dog is very good.
Cream
cheese and
that.
Sriracha on a hot dog. Oh man, that's good. That's what I discovered.
Nice.
So yeah, Steve, and then we left.
Yeah, that's the thing. We were cut out. We had to cut out of it a little bit early.
Yeah, so we'll have to have someone else report about the last day.
Yeah.
But we went to Seattle, and all you got was this lousy podcast.
That's right. That's it.
But the cool thing was we it's really expensive to get to the airport, so we wound up splitting a taxi together, Steve, Tessa, and I, and it was this kind of cool sort of, you know, goodbye. And I think, Steve, that listeners of this show like that we're actually friends.
I hope so.
Because I know when I listen to people's podcasts, when they're, you know, more than one people, like, the idea of them actually hanging out is kind of cool. Mm-hmm. So I do think it's kind of a cool thing of us kind of being at the airport and, like, you know, saying, okay, catch you later next time. After all of the Celebration Europe footage, our sign out will be in line at...
airport security.
At airport security while I'm chugging I was chugging the Ewok root beer, which was given another one of the giveaways. Someone made homebrew root beer to give to people. Steve, what is wrong with people in Seattle?
I don't know.
Nice and giving, and why do they have such nice collections?
It's what is so right about them.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I mean, but I'm from Boston, so I have to say it backwards.
Well, you know.
So awesome, Steve. So I think I'm just going to put a little music sting in between the Celebration Europe thing just to cleanse our palate from one set of things to the next. Let's do that. Steve, have you heard the footage I'm about to play?
Not yet. I am eagerly awaiting, because what I heard, there was plenty of shenanigans over in Germany.
And I haven't heard it either. I just checked to make sure that I got it. Chris asked me, hey, Skye, did you listen to that? And I was sort of like, no, which he was disappointed in. But I don't really have any excuse other than I was still trying to get over the fact that I didn't make it out to Celebration Europe.
Yeah.
But by all accounts, Seattle was more fun than Germany. So I'm very excited to listen to this fully, not just check to make sure that we got it, hear what happened. It seems like it went very well. It seems like the giveaways...
So the Star Tots turned out really well, and it sounds like everyone just had an awesome time. But don't take my word for it, Steve. Let's listen to Chris Georgoulias as he navigates his way through Essen, Germany.
Das Easter Celebration Europe Coverigen. Meet Chris Georgoulias und die Freundisch der Krieg der Stern Archiven. Meet Staubstauger. Your celebration Europe coverage with Chris Georgoulias and the Star Wars friends with the vacuum cleaner. Yeah.
Chris Georgoulias
and Matthias Wendel.
We're here reporting live from Celebration Europe 2 in Essen, Germany. We're at the room sales at the Atlantic Congress Hotel.
Better known as the Turkish sauna. It's like very warm in there.
It's very warm. It's about 11:45. Room sale started about 45 minutes ago, so we're a little bit late. It was really busy in here. It's really about half full now, but lots of tables. We found this nice open area. A lot of freestanding tables. People have set up. They're on the floor. There's some bigger tables in here. We see all kinds of stuff, so we'll kind of walk around here. The closest guy we see now is James Gallo. See, James has got some AFA carded figures, some droid cells,
some German Vespin security guards.
Palatoy, but good try.
That was Palatoy.
Okay. It's overpriced anyway, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah, so going around the corner here
to Ross Cuddy.
Ross Cuddy, Canadian's finest. Got some Celebration 5. Oh, we see Dave Myatt over here. Dave, we're recording for Sky Payne and the Star Wars Collector's Eye podcast.
That guy, yeah.
The podcast. And the Grand Poobah himself, Gus Logan, is here.
Hey, Sky, you're missing out. There's like a rocket pet here. There's awesome proof cards.
And everyone's topless.
But it's all guys. It's all dudes.
But topless nonetheless.
That's right. Sorry. Yelling cow dubs over here.
Hey, guys. Wampa Wampa. Like they were saying, they're topless, but it's all guys. It's a giant sausage fest here.
Bratwurst. German sausage fest.
Yeah.
A lot of bratwurst in here.
But it's the Rocket Pet room sales. Our first Rocket Pet. $15,000.
All right. Biggest, highest priced item at room sales yet.
I got an early bird kit.
Oh, yeah. I got one of those, too. We have a exclusive delivery of the San Diego Comic-Con exclusive the Alien early bird package. I got a couple myself, one for Bruce White, friend of the podcast. Here's Shane Turgeon. We're recording for the Vintage Pod, otherwise known as the Star Wars Collector's Archive Podcast.
I'm really terrible at talking on camera and in recordings and stuff like that. I wouldn't. I'm
just say Wampa Wampa and leave.
What do you want me to say?
Wampa Wampa.
Hey, Sky, you're missing out.
Wampa Wampa, eh? Sky, you better get over here, you hoser, because you're missing out on Europe.
That's right. Shane's too busy now to hang out with the little peeps. He's going on. Oh, he's got some kind of bootleg diecast something or other in his hand. Oh, and we're here. Dave Trees display. He's got his Farthest From series of flocked figures. You guys should check it out on farthestfrom.com. We got Flock Baca and Admiral Flock Bar. And over here, you can hear.
You can hear Loud Mike all over the convention as always. He's selling bootleg stuff all over the place.
Yeah, he's one of Matthias's countrymen. You can hear him from here.
So it's hard.
Hey, Mike, I want to talk to Sky Payne and the podcast.
Wampa? Wampa something?
That's half of it.
Wampa Wampa!
There you go.
It's hot. Some warm clothes, jackets, gloves. It's ice cold down here in Germany.
So Mike, for the people who don't know you, why don't you tell them about your Star Wars store?
Well, actually, I closed it last month.
Oh, you closed it last month. It's close enough.
It's close enough, yeah. Well, I have to go by the time, and, you know, everybody's buying on the internet.
Yeah.
So, me too.
Oh, no. Even Mike's
buying from the internet. He shut himself down.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. He's the guy with the Repro Don't Buy, Don't Sell t-shirts. You guys have seen those around with the Vader and the cross lightsabers.
Yeah, very famous designer.
Very famous designer. Yeah, there was a book written about him, I think.
He likes the great cloth.
Yeah.
The ho is here.
Another friend of the podcast.
Wampa Wampa.
We all love Derek Ho.
Hey, we all love Derek Ho.
Hey ho, hey ho. Hey ho, hey ho, hey ho.
Oh, Derek, I think you just have your own drop now. You're welcome, Skye. It was organic.
Biggest
it was organic.
Let's say something to Gregory.
Yes, Gregory from Singapore as well.
Hi.
Say Wampa Wampa, guys.
Wampa Wampa, guys.
It's one of Derek's friends here. Derek's bringing the whole countryman here.
He's brought like a hard copy for Black Bass Finger.
Here, to say something for the podcast.
Wampa Wampa. This is Per Lindstrom.
Per Lindstrom from Sweden, another. The Swedes have drank all the beer in Essen, if you can believe that.
You want some beer?
Matias needs a refill. There you go. No thanks, Zach. I'm good. Let's move on. Oh, we have here Bill Cable, the hunk, known as the hunk. We're recording for the Star Wars Collectors Archive podcast here.
Okay. What am I supposed to say now?
Talk about the room sales.
The room sales are really high.
Literally.
Yeah, literally. Was that the molds were just for display, or was he actually? Oh. Okay.
There's no mold on that display.
Chris is interested in himself, that's why.
Yeah, I haven't seen no molds.
All right, we had enough of Bill Cable. We're going to move on.
I like that.
Here we got Jonathan.
Oh, Jonathan's here with all the foodstuffs. Jonathan, would you like to talk to the folks at the Vintage Pod, otherwise known as the Star Wars Collectors Archive Podcast?
Hey, Vintage Pod, how are you? Things are going pretty well, sold some stuff. Matias is here. Party's going on.
Jonathan's here selling all kinds of food packaging items from across the globe here. He's got a set of Celebration.
I'm trying to get this garbage out of the house.
He's clearing out the garbage. I see some medallions from Europe, Celebration Europe 1, and cereal boxes. Celebration 5 cereal box giveaways. That was Paul. But you love the collector panels.
Avid fan, just I'm a permanent part of the room, basically.
Yeah, Paul's a wallflower here at the collector panel, so he's cruising around checking out what people have for sale. We're gonna mosey on. Thanks, Paul. Moving on here. Moving on. Oh, we have Michelle from Minton Box. You're talking to Skye Payne from the Kivecast and Steve Danley.
Oh, well, hello, everybody. Guys. I'm fine. This very terrible fit place here.
Yeah, yeah. Tell them about what you see at the room sales that you picked. Yes. It's really impressive.
It's very hot.
It's very hot.
It's very hot,
everybody.
Place. Very nice pieces.
Yeah.
I hope for something to buy, but I need looking for again.
Oh, okay. Well, so I'm sure you'll find them.
Yeah, sure.
Definitely.
Okay.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Pierre's out taking. Pierre. Michelle's taking photos here from mittenbox.net. Excellent French collecting site. Thanks, Michelle. We're going to say hey to a competing podcast here. You might recognize this voice.
Hello.
It's Marjorie from Star Wars Action News. She just gave us the shoo away hand gesture.
No, I'm selling water.
I'm kidding. Oh, water. That's the hottest thing
like
going here.
200 euros. He's buying, it's like selling most of everything.
2 euro. That's
2 euro.
It's a bargain.
So they're thinking ahead. They're giving the people what they need, not what they want. Thanks, Marjorie. Yeah, so we're here. More place. Who else do we know here?
Michael.
Michael Gilkey. Another German. Oh, another Mittenbox.net. Pierre. Pierre, what are you doing? Talk to Star Wars Collectors
Archive. We are sweating a lot, really.
Yes.
But a lot of amazing stuff there, so you should have been there, but you know, I just lost 2 liters of water, so I need to take more now.
Yeah, Marjorie's selling it over here. Star Wars Action News, they're selling water on the floor over there. Yeah, so we're rushing around. Michael Gilkey is going to say Wampa Wampa to the Star Wars Collectors Archive.
Wampa Wampa.
Podcast.
Hey, hello, guys.
Tell them how you're doing today with your sales.
The sales are going really slow. I wish everything was gone direct and I could go and drink some beer. It's such hot here. Really, really hot.
He's got like 2-3 packs. The Captain Mark 3 packs. I don't even dare to ask about their prices. And maybe they're not for sale, only for trade. What's up with them, Michael? The 3 packs?
The 3 packs are 1,300 euro.
Yep.
And but it's only opened one. No more sealed.
No more sealed.
And you used to have an unproduced Cloud Copilot Path to Force Proof card. What happened with that?
It's gone.
Oh, wow. Power of the Force Proof card.
And he says the sales is going slow. Yeah. I don't know. Like,
he's talking about quantity. He's got great stuff here. Nice German stuff.
Posters, even some Swedish Path to Force catalogs, Danish catalogs.
Ewok store display.
Yeah, PvP stuff, Ewok store display, good stuff.
Yes, excellent. All right, Michael, thanks. Good luck.
Yes.
I know it's thinned out a little bit here. Moving on.
Isaac.
Who's down here? Isaac Liu.
Talk to Isaac. Himself.
He's over here. He's fanning himself. He's a big fan. Thought you talk to Skye and Steve and everybody
else. Skye. Convention's awesome, but it is extremely hot. They don't believe in AC in Germany, and I don't like it. But everything else is awesome.
Yeah.
Having a good time. Sold some stuff, which is good. Wampa Wampa.
Thanks, Isaac. Isaac's got some carded figures here. Some AFA loose graded figures. We're moving around. Daniel wants to talk to the Star Wars Collectors Archive podcast.
Yeah, of course.
One of Matthias's countrymen here and on the forum member. Tell us what you think about the room sales. Except, don't talk about how hot it is.
Yeah. I think the room sales are pretty good, but as you just told me.
Yeah, Daniel's got sweat beating off of his forehead. You know, he does have his sunglasses on because it is midnight.
Yeah.
No, but they're on top of his head.
As I don't have any hair, everything's...
Down in his face.
We're heading over to UK, guys. Darren Simpson has got like the best booth in the convention.
Darren Simpson has an impressive booth on the show floor, and he's here. He got here late, so he's in the corner, and he's running away. We're at Graham's booth, I think, here. Graham, why don't you tell everybody of the Star Wars Collectors Archive what you think about the room sales?
How you doing, Chris? Yeah, it's going well here today. I bought probably... It's really hot in here. It is... I mean, you think Florida is hot, but Florida has air conditioning, and this has air conditioning, but it's on a European scale.
It is on a European. I want to point out that Graham was wearing shorts earlier today. Right now, he has long pants on. Darren Simpson has long pants and long sleeve, even though he knows how, and he's got a coat and a jacket. He's fashionable as hell.
He's a businessman. He looks like Brian Selman in the catalog.
Yeah, that's right. So, finish up.
But Matthias has been changing clothes today more often than Beyonce does at one of her concerts.
That's right. That's right. He's got a look. He's got a shirt now. It says "From Sweden with Love." It's a graffitied ad. Darren runs Star Zone. Darren's making a business deal over here. Let's say Wampa Wampa, guys.
Wampa Wampa.
Thanks, Darren.
We're heading over to the Stéphane Foucault.
The French Connection. We have an international convention. Stéphane Foucault with his new book. We're talking to Skye Payne and all the guys at the Star Wars
Hi, Skye.
Tell us about your stuff for sale here.
Yeah, so I have some interesting stuff here. The Mechano cards and an Empire Strike Back Boba Fett card. It's a recent one, but there are a lot of interest in it. So I'm I'm trying to send a few Western Jedi Mecha workouts. And the book is doing pretty well, and it's about you know, all the French stuff that was released in France, all the stuff, the toys and the food premiums and the posters and everything. So I strongly recommend it. You know,
very complete. Awesome. Thanks, Stefan. Yeah, we're gonna move on here. We're gonna talk to a Dane over here, Henrik Rasmussen.
And I look forward to do the podcast with Sky because I never did it before.
Oh, you never listened to it. Now he's gonna listen to it because he's on it. So
it's an open call to do it. Yeah.
Okay. So Stefan's gonna, even though he pimped your book, you didn't even hear about it last episode. He's been talking about it. So we'll try to get some international listeners here. Now we're talking to Henrik Rasmussen. Tell them where you're from, Henrik.
Hello there. This is Henrik Rasmussen from Denmark.
Denmark's adjusted. How's the room sale going for you today?
The room sale is awesome. It's damn hot in this room, but the room sale is awesome. First time I really experienced it. The first time in Europe, there was no room sales, but I see some amazing stuff here.
Yeah, that's right.
Henrik the Wrestler.
Henrik the Wrestler. Henrik's also one of our StarTOT sponsors. He sponsored the Imperial Dignitary.
Greatest of all the vintage figures. Greatest figure ever.
greatest vintage figure ever. But, doing great out here. Henrik's our variation expert. And right now he's enjoying the room sales. Yes. And the convention.
There have been quite a few variations. I saw some PvP ones for sale.
I know my tires, but I have not bought any variations. I have settled down a bit on variations. It has gone too far, but there are still some nice ones I would like.
Nice.
Yeah. There you go. You heard it from the horse's mouth. Now the European guys are...
It's gone too far.
It's gone too
far. I quoted him.
It went too far, even for the Europeans.
Yes.
Anyway, thanks, Henrik. Yes. All right, let's see. We saw some... There's some kilted 501st guys who just passed. Oh, there's a more right here. Another country of representation. Luis Galvez from Mexico City, Mexico. Luis, you're going to talk to Sky Payne and Steve Danley and everyone at the Star Wars Collectors Archive podcast.
Okay. Hello.
Hello.
To all the friends who's here in this amazing podcast, yeah.
That's right. And I'm telling Luis is one of the original Lily Lady experts. True Lily Lady expert. Bought them as a kid. Written about them in magazines. He came up with the Lily Lady fact sheets.
Yes.
Right? What were those called?
Oh, I can say...
I forgot what they're called. Anyway, you can edit this part. I can't remember. It was in the... Anyway.
I want that ship, not exclusive.
Luis was selling some cereal boxes from Celebration 5. He and his wife, Josefina, sponsored the Fetty's box. And they're also sponsors of a StarTOT for this set, the EV99.
Yes, I am amazed with the quality of those toys, and I am happy to be honored to be a sponsor of the EV99. And all the designs are fantastic. The job of the team is great, and I know that all the collectors in this celebration will enjoy them.
Great. Thanks, Luis. We all appreciate it. All the collectors appreciate it. Looks like you're gonna pack up here. And
he's got a very nice cereal box right in front of him.
That's right. And this is one that Matthias did the artwork for, so he's a little biased there, but it's great.
Oh yeah, that's great. Correct. Oh, I thought it looked good.
All right, we're gonna move along here. Thanks, Luis.
We got two Belgian collectors over here. Been collecting since '86.
Old school Belgian collectors.
Yeah. Did you? Say hello to the Kayakas, the Star Wars Collector podcast.
Hi, hello.
Didier, tell them what your old username used to be, or is it still?
No, it's not still, but it used to be Anti-Yoda.
Anti-Yoda, for all you guys that remember the Usenet news groups, this is Didier Vroeger, and he was Anti-Yoda, been around for a long time. I'm sorry, I didn't meet you yet. My name's Chris.
My name is Ben, hi.
Ben, hi Ben.
Hi.
Quite old school as well.
Old school.
Early 90s.
Yes.
Oh yeah. Well, thanks, guys. Just moseying around. Did you find anything good? See, Ben's got some Pepperidge Farm cookies and cookie boxes and Reese's Pieces.
Big time.
He's in for food stuff.
For the food stuff.
Yeah, so he's been hanging out with Jonathan Booth over here, apparently.
Yeah,
big time.
All right, thanks. We are getting ushered away. Thanks, guys. By James Burns from a competing collector podcast.
yeah, competing but friendly, and friendly. You know, very, very much so. We're all in this together, and it's great to work together as we have done before in the past.
That's right. That's right. And James is going to describe this, but without using the word hot.
This is a
amazing, or warm.
Okay, this is an amazing gathering of like-minded collectors looking, and there's some amazing pieces out here from vintage, from small items ranging from a few euros to the most expensive item, which is a rocket-firing FET for 15,000 euros. So wow. There really is something here for absolutely everybody. It's one of the best swap meets that we've seen at Celebration in the last few years.
I would say, yeah.
And I picked up a couple of Star Tours bits, which are really nice.
Nice.
And I think Star Tours is sort of trending at the moment because
yeah.
of Disney.
You go. James has admitted to being a Disney speculator, so.
Yeah. So I've grabbed a couple of those bits, and I've sold a couple of Vodafone posters to Duncan. And yes, some other stuff, so it's good.
Awesome.
Really good.
Awesome, thanks. And that's James from the Curto Burns Collector Cast. They normally record regularly, but I think they haven't been too regular lately. But great podcast, you guys, very professional. Dan and James do a great job on there. And
we are back to regular podcasts. We've had a crazy few months. I've been recording a TV show and sorting out the caravan of the Force, which is now in Essen, and we're going home on Monday. So it's been a crazy, crazy time, but we are back to regular shows, which is where we need to be. So good news for everyone.
That's great. Yeah, that's right. And James, and then why don't you explain Caravan of the Force to some of these guys?
So Caravan of Force was a crazy idea that we came up with the night after Celebration Europe was announced in the States last year. And we came up with this idea of moving from the UK across Europe, driving across, stopping in each country, meeting each garrison, doing something fun, grabbing a Star Wars celebrity and taking them on the caravan with us, and raising money, most importantly, raising money for Make-A-Wish. So Jeremy Bullock, graciously, within a second of me asking him whether he would come, said yes. So Jeremy Bullock and his wife Maureen joined us on the whole caravan, and we did some crazy things and had some amazing fun along the route. And we were greeted in Essen on Wednesday by about 200 people, including Lynn Howe, Mary Franklin, loads of other people from Lucasfilm. And we got an amazing reception, and we're still raising money for Make-A-Wish. And it's absolutely fantastic. So thanks everyone for their support. And we've got some amazing collector-focused eBay auctions coming up, including a Star Wars Xbox that's been signed by over 30 stars of Star Wars. Mark Hamill, Carrie Fisher, Dave Prowse, Anthony Daniels, Kenny Baker, Dave Filoni, Gary Kurtz, you name them, they've signed this box. So it's going to be a really, really nice eBay auction. No one's done it before. We've got photographs of everybody as they signed it, and we're hoping to raise a lot of money for Make-A-Wish.
Wow, that's impressive. I didn't know. This is the first time I'm hearing that, so awesome. I hope it works out. James, it's a great idea. Thanks for everything you're doing here with the hobby and everything, and the guys in the UK. Everybody's learning about collecting the right way through James. He's schooling everybody. And he didn't use the word hot. So, or warm. So that's great. It's all in the positivity. It's probably cooled off a little bit, you know.
Yeah, the doors are open in the back.
Doors are open in the back. We've lost a lot of people now. It's 12:15. Wow. A lot of looky-loos. Maybe people not so much hanging out. There is a bar across the lobby.
Yep.
I'm sure a lot of people retreated to that. Anyway, thanks, James.
Pleasure. See you soon.
Thank you. And I grabbed this guy, Kevin Lentz, over here. You guys know him from the forum. Let's say hey to Skye and Steve, Kevin.
Hey, Skye. Hey, Steve.
Tell them what you think about the room sales over here.
Rooms, all kinds of awesome stuff to see. I am really boring. I didn't bring anything to sell, and all I bought was a t-shirt, but fun window shopping.
Awesome, awesome. Well, I hope you found some stuff at least interesting. You know, everybody's having a good time. So, UK hooligan, Andy Davies. Say hey to Skye.
Hey, Skye, how's it going?
Tell him about your... he's not on the phone. We're recording for the podcast.
Okay. I wonder what you're doing.
Well, this guy's waiting for you to respond, but, you know, it's going to be delayed.
FaceTime. Okay, so, yeah it's hot in his room, so... but there's some nice pieces, and I hope this gets... this finally makes it onto your podcast, because last time you interviewed me, it all went up.
Oh, my God, it went up. My up's not going to make it, so you keep beeping that part out when we say up, but anyway... So what did you want to say last time that got cut out?
I was all about the loop Bespin 12-inch box flat that I was trying to find. And if that's if anyone's listening to this and knows what one is, then send me an email, PM me on Rebel Scam, because I am actively searching for one of those. I would love to add it to my collection.
That's right, yeah. So if you know what he's talking about, you know what it is. For those of you who don't, he's talking about the unproduced 12-inch Empire Strikes Back Luke Bespin. He's looking for the box flat to go with his set, and great bloke. And if you have it, it's definitely going to a good home over here. And kivecast@gmail.com, they'll forward it on to him, I'm sure. Thanks, okay. Andrew.
See you later, Sky.
See you guys.
See ya.
Everything I want costs thousands. Hello.
Say that one more time.
Everything that I want that they have here costs thousands. Everything you want that they have here costs dollars.
Dollars. He bought a Jar Jar Binks watch. Yeah, so that was Arnie from Star Wars Action News.
Well, technically, let's clarify, the watch is not for me. The watch is for Marjorie of Star Wars Action News.
Oh, I see. But they live in the same house. It'll be in the same under the same roof with both of them.
Absolutely. Actually, I picked up two Jar Jar items tonight. I got a unarticulated Jar Jar from Hong Kong.
Oh, my gosh. And how can you have unarticulated Jar Jar? He's all articulated. That's great. Hong Kong, huh? Big Jar Jar fan.
Yeah.
So anybody got random Jar Jar stuff, you know where to send it over here. We have one person. It's going to be the black hole of Jar Jar items.
It's almost like a Humane Society thing. It's like, oh, you know, you get the Sarah McLachlan playing and all the discarded Jar Jar items that need a home.
And at the end, you put them in a big metal tin, you put cyanide gas in it, and because you have too much. Maybe not cyanide. I don't know if they use, actually. Anyway, saw you guys standing over here. Thanks again.
Thanks,
hope you had a good time, and you didn't say it was hot. Thanks. We already know it's hot. All right.
And one happy camping.
Oh, my goodness.
I completed a deal.
Matthias completed a deal.
1 year of pestering. I finally met an awesome guy from Belgium tonight, and we've been looking for each other for all day, and now we made a deal. 1 year. That's rewarding.
That is rewarding. Well, congrats on that, Matthias.
Thanks.
I was going to talk to another German. I'm looking for her.
We got Martin from
Mike.
I saw
Martin. We saw Martin. You know, I saw Mike Vogt over here. He ran off. Oh, Marco. I've been wanting to meet Marco. I haven't met him. My name's Chris Georgoulias. I did the first day. Yes. You know what? That's right, I did. And you didn't say, hey, I brought my buttons.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I got stiffed. He had the coolest buttons, the PVP buttons, the Meccano button. Oh, is it Meccano PVP and Lily Letty? That's right. I met Marco the first day, and he's out of buttons now.
I'm sorry, yeah.
Damn it. You can leave that in. I missed my opportunity. Gave him all away before the last day.
Shift happens.
Oh, you did?
Shift happens. Shift happens.
No.
Oh, wow.
Awesome. Oh, you still get ours.
Thanks. I'm sorry. I've just witnessed an introduction. Michael Ritter, New York, meets Gonzalo Diaz.
From Spain.
From Spain. You guys might know Gonzalo from the forums. He used to live in Brazil. Tell him how you travel through Brazil to Russia now, and then you have these Russian
bootlegs. Yeah, I travel often to Russia. Like, I have I travel to the former Soviet Union like 10 times a year, and I was able to find the bootleggers who produce the vintage and the modern line of bootlegs. And I'm offering the modern ones here because there isn't any vintage stuff left.
Yeah, yeah. Did you hear that, guys? He met the company that made the actual original Russian bootlegs, and now he's got a few Russian bootlegs. Chewbacca, Yoda, some really very pink Bosk, Vaders.
Really
very
pink,
neat stuff. Direct from Russia, from a Spaniard, so it works out perfect.
Yeah.
International.
Very international. So, Mike, you want to say hey to Skye and Steve?
Hey, Skye, Steve, you're missing a great time here. I've already lost my voice twice. Wampa Wampa, guys, enjoy.
Yeah, I'm not going to make Mike talk. Mike worked the Rancho Obi-Wan booth on Friday. Friday night we had dinner. You could not hear him. He greeted so many people and talked. He completely lost his voice. He got it back a little bit, and I'm not going to push it. So we're going to mosey on over here. Gary Smith, you want to talk to Skye Payne and Steve Daly of the Star Wars Collectors Archive podcast or recording? Live from the Celebration Europe 2
Okay.
Room sales. And Gary's looking at me, he's like, I don't know what you're talking about. See, it's an all vintage podcast that he should be listening to. They're going on, what, 2 years now. They can't decide on what name to call it. Sometimes they call it the Vintage Pod, sometimes it's the Kivecast from the Star Wars Collectors Archive. Gus Lopez's site, all vintage stuff. You know,
I think it's like, and Gary's like the most known and biggest Peltzer collector around. You have to
That's
be.
That's right.
Possibly.
Gary's been around. Possibly. Big pallet toy guy over here. He's got his arms folded. He doesn't know what to make of anything. He's very hot. I know
I
that.
Am hot.
And but tell him what you think about the convention so far and the room sales.
Awesome. Absolutely brilliant. It's been the first ever one. I've enjoyed it thoroughly, even though I've not bought anything or sold anything.
Hey, neither have I, but hey, we can all enjoy it. So yeah,
getting to meet people, it's been awesome.
That's especially right, it's all about meeting the people. We have a complete international contingent. I don't know how many different countries we've just talked to on this one. It's been a lot, so we have entire Europe presence and US presence. It's all great. Thanks, Gary. Shane's gonna say some closing words.
I love you.
Thanks, Shane. Shane loves everyone. We're gonna go talk to Duncan Jenkins real quick. I see Duncan. I'm gonna flag him. I see a couple of people. Oh, I see a few people I want to talk to. Duncan Jenkins. We're gonna talk to Skye and Steve.
Hey guys, Wampa Wampa, everybody.
Tell them about some room sales.
All right. So let's see. Looks like I've got a lot less over there in my pile. So it's been traded or sold away pretty well. My lovely wife is taking care of business for me, so she always
like
is.
Always.
Like always, exactly. Leaving me free to roam and purchase. So,
but you got like only a stack of stuff.
Yes.
And you're like, the usual, well, always when Duncan is buying, he's got his iPad and his list of stuff
does,
to
yeah,
check what he's got and what he doesn't have.
That's right.
So while, Genghis Khan rapes and pillages, Duncan Jenkins over here roams and purchases.
That's right.
Sorry, rape and pillage, Roman purchases. I had it in my head earlier, then Matias cut in and I screwed the whole joke up.
It,
I thought it was really funny in my head.
I
it was better in my head, yeah.
You
know. And I couldn't remember Genghis Khan. But anyway.
I picked up a few things, so that was kind of cool. The nicest thing that I got was actually before the room sales.
Of course.
Yes. French card. It's a vacuum-formed trading card from Empire Strikes Back for a cookie promotion that I have been looking for about 20-some-odd years. So I was glad to finally find one.
Awesome. Duncan, the man, he pulls these things out. You've never even heard of it. Not even the concept. And he says, hey, I found it. And I was looking for that number. That's great. Gus is like, what are you talking about? Of course we all know about that. Gus is back. Gus is back. He's still
most
got his...
Most of my stuff's free stuff.
Stuff's
I hardly
free.
Spent anything. I got a lot of gifts, though. It's pretty awesome.
We have to mention, like, one of the best
The
patch.
Best thing I got to have, a David Hasselhoff Celebration Europe patch.
Oh, my God. I have not seen that.
That thing is awesome.
Great.
Germany loves the Hoff.
Who did that?
Loud Mike.
Loud Mike?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm going to
yeah, he's got a bunch of them.
Mike.
You can buy one.
Oh, sh**.
Yeah.
Oh, heck.
Awesome.
Yeah. All right. The David Hasselhoff patch.
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to go make my first purchase here at the room sales from Loud Mike. Yeah. Thanks, guys.
Bye-bye.
That was Duncan and Gus.
Yeah.
Matias is going to hang out with them.
Yeah.
Matias is looks like he needs a little bit of sleep. So I'm going to walk over here. We're looking at Ben here.
I'm
Chris Georgoulias. I'm recording for the Star Wars Collectors Archive podcast, the Kivecast. Say hi to the guys.
Hey, how's it going?
Do you ever listen to the podcast?
I do, yeah.
You do?
Yeah,
so it's Skye Steve. Tell them what you think about the room sales.
The room sale is off the hook, man. There's stuff here I've never seen before, never ever in my whole life. Like, there's grail piece after grail piece here.
Norwich contingent, nice meeting you. Thank you. See you. We talked to James. Tell us about Caravan of the Force.
I'm Matt Booker from Jedi News.
That's right, Matt.
And we've been traveling across Europe with Jeremy Bullock and Maureen Bullock in our car for Luke's film on StarWars.com, raising money for Make-A-Wish.
Awesome.
So it's been really good fun. And I've come to swap meet, and it's the best place at every celebration.
That's right. It is. When the collectors do it, they do it right. You know, the 501st aren't the only ones doing big, organized things, even though it really wasn't completely organized, but you put the word out,
yeah.
You find a space, and it happens.
Definitely. Found some really nice Boba Fett pieces. Found a really nice purple Mexican bootleg Boba Fett, my Boba Fett cloak.
Awesome.
Collection.
Awesome. and trying to sell Dave's flocked figures here still. I'm surprised they're still here. They're awesome. You guys need to go to farthestfrom.com, check out these figures.
Yeah, he's gone off wandering, finding shiny crappy, doesn't he?
Awesome, awesome. Thanks, Matt.
Cheers, man.
See ya. All right, I think I see a bunch of tired faces over here. I've been recording for 40 minutes, and everything's pretty much wound down. Just people kind of hanging out and talking. A lot of beers from the bar across the way, and it has cooled off a lot. People are starting to pack up. At its height, it was really packed in here, so another successful room sales. And, I see one more guy I'm going to talk to, another German. Real quick, before he runs off, Mike Vogt is going to talk to the Star Wars Collectors Archive podcast.
I'm happy to do so, Chris, and thanks for meeting you finally, because I just heard that you want to get rid of a certain item that a guy from Germany needs, so you should stay in touch with him. But apart from that, it was very nice meeting you, very nice meeting the other guys here, and thanks for this idea with the Star Tots. Very brilliant idea, and I got the fever already, and I have to collect the line. Thank you very much, and good luck.
Awesome, thank you. And tell me your name. I see a guy here. He's wearing the headman shirt, the inner circle. Tell everybody who your name is.
Darren Wild.
Darren Wild. You guys know him from the forum, and I'm just meeting him for the first time. I do is know his
famous
name.
Famous bootleg collector.
Famous bootleg collector. Tell the guys, tell Skye and Steve, hey, and you got the whole world listening. Tell us about what you think about the bootleg selection here at the room sales.
Minimal, but the couple of items that are here, they've been just what I've been looking for.
There you go. And we completed another bootleg collection. We have Martin, and now Darren has completed something. He has got a tiny C-3PO that he's going to explain.
It's a Dutch bootleg, and John Alvira's got my last one, and I've been looking for another ever since, and I've just found one.
There you go. See, the bootleggers have found success here.
Yes.
And maybe the food collectors, not so much, but you know, that's how it works sometimes. But everybody's happy. We're all in it together. More country. Tell them where you're from.
England.
Another English bloke. We've got everybody here. A lot of English guys we've talked to on this one. All right, guys. Thanks, Mike. We'll talk to you later. Hey, Darren. Nice meeting you. All right. I think that's going to be it. If I keep walking around, I'm going to keep talking to people, and this thing's going to run for like an hour. So I'm going to cut it out. Thanks. You guys should have come. Another successful event. And see you at Celebration 7. Over and out.
Okay, Steve, so there it was. We're not going to record our official outro because, once again, we will just use the outro we recorded at the airport thing.
SeaTac
Airport. I'm not even going to check the baseball scores. That's how unrealistic, that's how different of an episode this is.
That's right.
And, yeah, I mean, it's been a really fun time. This sort of late summer time. I'm happy to get back into the swing of things, get back to recording an episode every month. We didn't even actually talk about the thing we did in S. Vic and Lisa's house. We recorded another podcast.
That's right. Yeah, that we were guests on another podcast.
Yeah, we were guests on the Galaxy of Toys podcast.
That's right.
And it was really fun, you know. It's weird, I think, because they're doing a podcast about Star Wars toys. I think maybe they feel like we would be territorial or possessive.
But hopefully they understand no.
Yeah, not one bit. No, definitely not one bit. Maybe one bit.
One bit?
One bit from me, maybe.
Okay.
But not a one bit I think is coming from my best self, so I just put it away. You know, maybe part of me is kind of like, oh, I see. Someone else is doing a Star Wars podcast, huh? Ours isn't good enough. but that one bit is not my rational self, you know what I mean?
Okay, all right.
I mean, I hate to get all, you know, whatever. If you guys have listened to us talk about how much fun we've had this far, you can hear me psychoanalyze myself. You get what I'm saying, right, Steve?
Yeah. Yes.
No, I'm really happy that they're doing their show, and they're good guys, and I listened to a couple episodes, and I should probably listen to more. Yeah, hopefully we're going to get to work together again, because there's only going to be more podcasts about Star Wars collecting toys, not less.
That's a good thing.
Only going to be more.
I guess until we speak later this month about the unnamed soldier.
Rebel soldier, right?
Yes, that's right.
All right, good. By the time we record that episode, I'll get that down.
All right.
Let's get to our pre-recorded clip.
Alrighty.
Hey, this is Rick Springfield saying, Wampa, Wampa.
Well, Steve and I just took the taxi to the airport here, Tessa. We're in the security line, Steve. It's been pretty busy, hey?
A little bit. I can only have one checkpoint for everybody.
And I'm chugging the Ewoks root beer that was made. And it looks like I'm drinking beer. But I'll include a picture of that. But anyways, it's been a fun show. Wampa Wampa.
Adios.
Action figures are not yet available, but this Star Wars early bird certificate package is in stores with its colorful Star Wars picture display tag and certificate.